event to honor. We also have this event to honor our past alumni who return, many of them annually, for this event or others, and to say thank you to a lot of the people that have been very helpful in the education of our residents, medical students, and people like me, because I'm continuing to learn, as I think the rest of our family would agree. But before we do anything this morning, I thought we'd have a moment of silence. One of the things we haven't done in the past is recognize people who have been influential in our program but have passed away in the last year. And that's something that happens at a lot of organizations, and we've not done that. We're going to do it the first time, and I would it's in your program there about the folks that we particularly know about, and as time goes by and you hear of people that have been influential in your training here, we want you to let us know, because I think this is a tradition we should start. These are all people that in a major way had an impact on the program, and actually I'm going to sit in the Milburn seat this morning, because Joe Milburn came to this meeting every year until he got to where he couldn't walk, and sat in that chair where my Diet Coke's sitting back there. So in his honor, I'm going to sit there this morning. So we have a moment of silence, please. Thank you. I want to go, we usually do this, and I'll miss some people along the way, but as folks come in, I try to recognize those people that we don't always get a chance to do so because they're not here for Grand Rounds or M&M or whatever, and look back in the, back there this morning and saw Richard Cook. Richard, raise your hand there, please. Richard's been very influential here since 1980 when we started the Skills Lab, and continues to be, and in the last year and 2 years has really invigorated and reinvigorated the program there, along with Nick Belay and Heath Giles and others, and really appreciate his effort always. A lot of our research activity is centered around things that Richard has helped make happen, and we're proud of him. I saw several other people. Bob Thomas back there. Bob comes every year. We can't get him to stay around long, but he's here for the morning program, and we love having you here, Bob. Bob was a nice, soft-spoken resident. I still remember he called me one night and said, you know, I've got a patient here, I think, might have a ruptured spleen. I said, oh, Bob, come on. No, I really think so. And I said, well, you know, won't it, we'll just wait a little while. Can't we treat it? Now, this is before we did non-operative treatment. So, no, you know, really, you're going to have to get up and come on in, Dr. Burns. So, he was a soft-spoken but forceful individual. Sitting next to him, Gene Scanlon, local plastic surgeon of great note, and also a major contributor to our effort here financially, and we appreciate what you do for us. Ralston Major came in. The whole Major family has contributed a lot of hot bodies to the residency program, but has also been a contributor. And Clark Kennedy, who recently left us but has come back to visit, we're glad to have Clark here with us. Looking at other folks that we will recognize as the day goes on, but we're happy to have everyone. I want to remind everyone that tonight the program is not at the Choo Choo. I fully expect that people who didn't read their mail will, who decide to come, will end up at the Chattanooga tonight saying, well, where's the party? But it's going to be at the Westin Hotel, and it starts at 6 o'clock. Right, Cindy? Okay. And everyone's welcome, and we hope you'll be there. All right, we're going to go ahead and get started with the program as we always do. Start out with one of the with one of our chief residents. Everybody, I think, pretty much knows that all chief residents do a grand rounds during their tenure here. Unfortunately, we don't have enough time on Saturday morning for all five of them to do it, so we have to draw short straws, and two of them have already done their presentations, Nico and Mary Catherine, and did superb jobs. It's a shame that all of you didn't have a chance to hear theirs. But there's going to start off this morning with Brent Soder. I think everybody pretty much here knows that Brent is a native of the West Coast, but went to medical school and college in South Carolina, and then we were able to recruit him here to be a resident, and he's done an outstanding job. And he's leaving us this next week to head back to the West Coast to do something, though, that not a lot of people get a chance to do. We do have some people who have, like Ralston Major. But he's got a chance to go work with his father as a surgeon in a practice in Oregon. And that's going to be a unique and great opportunity for him. And he's going to give us a talk here on the making of a surgeon. And I guess that references Chattanooga. We look forward to it, Brent. We're proud of you.
Well, thank you, Dr. Burns. And I do want to thank Dr. Burns and the whole Department of Surgery for the honor of the podium again. I'm tempted to say for the last time, but if my life has proven anything to me, is that we never know what's going to happen in our life. So I won't say for the last time, but we'll get started. I'm going to talk about surgical training and specifically training in Chattanooga, because I think it's somewhat of a unique situation that we have here in Chattanooga. So the agenda today is to talk about how we take five medical students, and after 6 years, we turn them into these five chief surgical residents that are ready to go out and practice. And as I started thinking about the training of a surgeon, looking at literature, and I recently came into possession of a original copy of the surgical papers by William Halsted. And this was published in 1924, the very last paper in these two volumes was a talk that he gave in 1904 at Yale University, the annual address in medicine. And the title of that paper is The Training of the Surgeon. And Dr. Halsted went through and discussed issues in training and how he had changed the system. Most of us know that the modern surgical residency program makeup is based upon Halsted's practices at Johns Hopkins University. And the residency process has changed over the years, but many of his principles still hold true. And in that paper, he mentions pain, hemorrhage, and infection as the three great evils. And I think as surgeons, those three things are what we're here to help alleviate. And he went on to say that we have reason to hope that the day will come when hemorrhage will be controlled by a quicker procedure than the awkward, time-consuming ligature, when infections will be controlled by specific products of the laboratory, and when pain will be prevented by a drug, which will have affinity only for the definite sensory cells, which is desirable it should affect. And he said that in 1904. And it's really, that sentence just struck me, because if you look at each one of those things, hemorrhage, we have so many ways to control hemorrhage now. Infection, the antibiotics that we have access to that he did not, and then pain medications. What we're able to do with anesthesia and pain control is so different than it was. So he was really ahead of his time identifying those three issues. And then he said there's the most intimate interdependence of physiology, pathology, and surgery. And I think that's why surgical training takes so long. If you look at how surgeons truly have to master physiology and pathology and anatomy, and there's so much that a surgeon has to master. So he kept his, on average, residents spent 8 years with him. Fortunately, we only have to spend six here, but in those 6 years, we have a lot to learn. And then the next book that I looked at when I was thinking about my talk is this one. It's called The Making of a Surgeon, and it's by William Nolan. He's a surgeon that in the 1950s trained at Bellevue Hospital in New York City. And it's kind of a strange connection, but the reason my uncle actually found this book at a swap sale somewhere. It cost 75 cents. You can see it was published in 1968. And it stood on our shelf in our library for a while. And I remember my grandfather, he came over from Ireland in 1927 at the age of 17. And he actually had his appendix removed at Bellevue Hospital in New York City. And that was kind of a connection when I saw that this book was from a surgeon from Bellevue. And so I picked it up when I was in high school and I read it. And I thought it was a great book. And I always wanted to be a surgeon. And then I read it again in college. And then this year I've read it again. And as I went through that book, these are the chapters of the book, after completing my residency, I realized that each chapter had some way that I could correlate to training today in Chattanooga. And I thought that would be an interesting talk, is to compare Bellevue in the 1950s, and that's in blue, that'll be kind of a theme, and then Chattanooga in orange, of course, as I go through my talk. So I went through and picked out some chapters that I thought really struck a chord with me. And what I've done is updated them basically how Chattanooga, if this book was going to be written by somebody from Chattanooga, what I think those chapters would be. So we'll go through these, each chapters, in the course of the talk. But these is... So surgical residency, I think, is an innately personal journey. That's not to say that we take this journey alone, but just to give you a little bit of background about how I got here. I was born in Roseburg, Oregon. It's a small town in southern Oregon on the North Umpqua River. It's a beautiful place to grow up. And then when I was 10, we moved to Kansas, and I completed high school there. And then I came to South Carolina, went to Furman University. There's a few alumni in the room today. And got a wonderful education there. I went to MUSC in Charleston for medical school. And then I came to Chattanooga. And I remember as I came through the doors at Erlanger, feeling that I've started a whole new phase in my life. And I started on a night float system when we used to have to do it that way. And June 30th, the night of, I came into Erlanger. I didn't know where the bathrooms were. I didn't know anything. But I knew I could just walk around. And so wandering through the hospital that night, carrying a pager and answering calls, I made myself my way to the trauma ICU. And in that ICU, I found Anna Royer. She was the third-year resident. Or just about to start her third year of residency. She had one more day as a second year resident. She was taking care of patients in the ICU, and she found me and said, "Hey, this patient needs a chest tube. You want to come do it?" And I said, "Sure. That's what I'm here for." So I did it, and I looked at Anna, and I thought, you know, she looks kind of tired. She looks like she's been working hard, and she tells me, "Well, tomorrow morning I'm waking up, and I'm driving to Athens, Tennessee, where we do our rural surgery rotation." But there she was that night taking care of patients, and it really, I remembered that fondly. And then that first month in the hospital, cruising through the wards, and it wasn't my idea, but somebody said, you know, if you're not doing anything, just walk around the hospital. Go to the wards, go to the ICUs, go to the operating rooms, just see what's going on, because you'll be amazed at what you find. And you find sick patients. I remember that month is where I learned that bleeding looks like a heart attack. So patients that you get sick and you have to take care of, and it was amazing how that first month entering into Erlanger, I learned so much. And what I learned that month is something that I remember from my interview day here. Dr. Burns told us on that first day that patients were the focus of why we're here. He has a pyramid, and at the top of the pyramid are the patients, and that's why we're here. And I think that's something that makes this program so strong, is that there's no question about the reason we're here. We spend countless hours taking care of patients, and I think that's where our education comes from. And there's some patients that'll never leave our mind. I think each one of us in this room can pull up the names of patients that we spent so many hours taking care of, and those patients and how we care for those patients will always stay with us. The next chapter, to err is human. Here in Chattanooga, I think we would just call that Thursday mornings. That's when we have our weekly morbidity mortality conference. And as Dr. Nolan in this book said, not some, not most, but all doctors at one time or another make errors. This is the nature of medicine. It's not an exact science. And he says if he did make a mistake, he doesn't want to make it again. If possible, he wants to learn something from his experience, which may help him and his patients in the future. And that's why every Thursday morning we come to this auditorium, and we sit and we talk about our cases that have complications, patients that die. And Dr. Smith runs that conference every week. I think most of us here would say it's the most educational conference that we have. And it is a long walk up to this podium, from the back row especially. And I got to do that on Thursday, my last M&M. I got to come up here and present. And it reminded me that no matter what we do, we're here to do things better. And it also reminded me, as you stand up here, so many times, so many of us had Dr. Kofor say things along the lines of, "Soder, I thought you were smart." And I remember that, and I always remember that. And he wasn't saying I was dumb. That's just the way Dr. Kofor said things. But it makes you think, and you have to constantly be thinking about what we've done and what we can do better to improve things. And it also shows us that the biggest trap that we can fall into is overconfidence, because no matter how much we know or how much we think we know, there's always more to know. And I think that's what surgery is about, is continuing to get better. And part of getting better is working with the team here. And he had a whole chapter about nurses, and I can't say enough about the nurses here in Chattanooga. It's actually one of the reasons I came to Chattanooga. I felt like the relationship between residents and nurses at my medical school was so poor, and I came to Chattanooga, and it just seemed like it was a team here. And there's no doubt that's a team sport. Communication is key, talking to the nurses. If you talk to them, they'll talk to you, and they'll let you know when patients get sick. and having a mutual respect for the nurses. And this is actually a topic that here in Chattanooga we've done research on. Dr. May and Dr. Bell, with the help of Dr. Maxwell and the trauma team, Dr. Barker, recently presented a talk on how we've utilized our trauma nurses, who are specialized nurses, to improve our massive transfusion protocol. And they showed that having these nurses come into the operating room and assist the anesthesia staff with a transfusion of our trauma patients truly helps. Moving on, Dr. Nolan wrote a chapter in his book called Pathology, 6 months in the death house. Well, here in Chattanooga, I'd like to think that we have Athens, which is 2 months in the layman house. This is the house that we spend time in. But we get to go to Athens, Tennessee. It's an hour north of here, and this is Dr. Lehman, who I see in the audience today. And as when I came to Chattanooga on my interviews, I told people, I'm going to be a general surgeon in a small town. That's what I was going to be, and that's what I knew I wanted to do. And coming here, one of the reasons I wanted to is because we actually are one of the few programs in the country that sends residents to a small town to get the experience of what it is like to be a general surgeon in a small town. And it was a great time. And if anything, I can say the cases that I did there, there were so many cases and patients to take care of, and you learn so much. The strength of that rotation, without doubt for us, is our endoscopy there. So here you can see I did 141 endoscopies during that time with 84 colonoscopies. And that number cannot be rivaled by any program in the whole country. So for us, if you want to be a general surgeon in a small town, being able to go and have that endoscopy experience is very, very valuable. And also, while you're up there, life doesn't stop. So they provide that house for us, which is so nice, and your family can come up. My family's pretty mobile and able to come up, and as you can see, they came up, spent weekends with me, and I was on call there, and life continued. Our daughter learned to walk in Athens. This is the great park there that we love spending time at, went fishing, and it kind of showed me that surgery in a smaller town can be quite a great lifestyle. And let me tell you, the future of Athens is very bright. Nick Ballet is going to be going to Athens this next year, and I think they have an idea of what they're getting, but I don't think there's any way to truly understand what you're getting until you've worked with Nick. They'll have the hardest working person in the whole town to give Dr. Lehman a run for that title. And trust me, all the residents going up there, you'll be asked what you got. So after you come back from Athens, you become a senior resident. And there's no real explanation about how that change happens. But Dr. Nolan put it well. He said, you could tell when you made first assistant resident, which I would consider what we call our senior residents, because suddenly there are more people asking you what to do than there were telling you what to do. And I think that's very true. And I have a very vivid memory of my first week as a senior resident doing an appendectomy with Dr. Smith. And he said, Soder, how many appendectomies have you done? And I sat there for a brief second, and I thought, that's a very loaded question. Because if I tell him I've done 100 appendectomies, and this appendectomy goes really wrong, I'll look like an idiot. But if I tell him I've only done 10 appendectomies, he might not let me do the case. So I gave him some answer, and tell him in the middle, 20 or 25. Well, looking back, I actually counted the numbers up, and I had done 38 appendectomies. With our peer rotation and things like that, we get such a good surgical experience. So actually, it was 38. And the other thing about being a senior resident that you learn, and Dr. Nolan again said it well, is helping an inept intern through a case requires nerves of steel and the patience of Job. It is most harrowing. And I think teaching is such an important part of our program here in Chattanooga, and that's true. And let me tell you, there's nothing like you can do an appendectomy, but teaching somebody else to do one, it gave me great respect for what our attending surgeons do here every single day. So as life in the hospital continues to change, as you progress, become a senior resident, move on, your life outside the hospital doesn't stop. And life on the home front is challenging at times. And again, Dr. Nolan said, the wife of an intern or resident could make or break him. Without ever setting foot in the hospital, and some of the wives never did, she could influence her husband so he couldn't do his job worth a damn. Or she could help him make a real success of his training. And I think that is so true. Because your family, residents here, the resident husband or wife or spouse or family, they make such a contribution to the residents' training. Fortunately, I've been blessed in my life to have Lauren as the true captain of the ship in our home, and she's done such a great job getting us through this. Because it's not easy. Physicians, it's been shown, have a divorce rate of 25%. This study out of Wisconsin, they actually looked back at a 25 years of all the residents that came through their training program. They found a 21% divorce rate in the 25-year follow-up. Fortunately, here in Chattanooga, another benefit of this program is that's been recognized. And this year, Dr. Greer and his wife and his daughter-in-law, who happens to be the wife of one of our up-and-coming chief residents, put together a forum for residents and family. And it was an opportunity for our attendings and the families and the residents all to get together and just talk about what it's like, because nobody else in the entire world understands what it's like. And so I was very appreciative of that this year, that's been recognized, because it is such a challenge. It's a great challenge, but it's a challenge. Because life goes on outside, but then you have to bring your life in the hospital. Birthdays, holidays, anniversaries, things like that happen, and you're on call. So fortunately, my family came to the hospital. This is Addie's fourth birthday here. I think this was Emmy's second birthday here. And then babies are born. I was on call in the ICU that night, and then my wife called me and says, it's time for baby number two. I think that's one. I lose count of them, actually. But I think that's baby number two there. One of the things we do here that's actually helpful with our family life is the way we do our surgical research. And surgical research is important. One of the things that Dr. Halstead mentioned in his paper is this quote from Lord Thurlow. So on the passage of the Charter for the Royal College of Surgeons in 1800, this was a time where surgery was a new thing. The barber surgeon was the thing, but they wanted to make surgery into a true profession. And he said, there's no more science in surgery than in butchering. And so I think over the last 218 years, we've shown that that's not true, and that's because of surgical research. And again, Dr. Halstead says, a warning for all time against satisfaction with present achievement and blindness to the possibility of future development. And I think that is so important. We can't be satisfied with what we have today, because otherwise we won't advance things. And so in that vein, surgical research has gotten an important part here in Chattanooga. In 1980, Dr. Kofer and Dr. Burns changed the way, or 1988, they changed the way the residency program here is. They added a year for research. And this time is split up between our years. And what they found is that change changed the number of papers from one to three. Basically, graduating residents used to have one research paper under their belt, and then after this, they have three. And I think our group is consistent with that as well. Great opportunity to do research here. And as research is so important for advancing surgical care, Dr. Nolan, in his book in the 1950s, he had a chapter on heart surgery. It was the early days of heart surgery. Things were changing. And if anything during my residency that I can relate to that, I think it's robotic surgery. It's a controversial topic, and it's new technology, and anytime new technology comes on, there's going to be controversy. And we're in that phase now where we're trying to find where the appropriate place for the robotic surgery is, and I think this program is doing a great job of that. I think we've compared it to laparoscopic cholecystectomy. People said that would never be a great thing, and it has become such a great thing. I think robotics has headed that direction too. And I think one thing that we can say for sure is that robotics is here to stay. Here's a graph looking at the percentage of robotic cases. This is in 2008, very low percentage, and this line is actually the percentage of cases that were done robotically in terms of minimally invasive cases. So robotics is growing, and I think it's here to stay. And I think the technology and the economics will adapt as we go forward. I don't want to be left behind. I don't think most people do. So here in Chattanooga, I remember in November 2015, Dr. Dark called me and said, hey, I'm going up to Pennsylvania to see some robotic thing. You want to come with me? I said, sure, absolutely. It's an opportunity. So we traveled to Pennsylvania, met this guy, Clark Gerhardt. He was a very prominent robotic surgeon. We went to Wilkes-Barre General Hospital in Scranton, Pennsylvania, and had a great time seeing him. He did six cases in the matter of 6 hours. He had two rooms, two teams, flipping back and forth between robots, and it was quite the experience for us. And we went down to Atlanta and did a wet lab training. In July 2017, Dr. Dowden called me and said, hey, I'm going up for some advanced hernia course. You want to come with me? Again, I said, sure, that'd be great. So we went up to Cleveland, Ohio, which actually is a pretty nice town. And we went to this hospital and met this surgeon, and he showed us how he's doing these very advanced major abdominal wall reconstructions. In August 2017, I got to go with Dr. Dowden down to Atlanta and get trained to do single-site cholecystectomy. This is the equipment they use for that. And then in March of this year, Dr. Giles invited me and Alan Hyde, who you can see right there, to go to Atlanta. And programs from all over the Southeast were coming to Atlanta to the lab there to get training. And this was an opportunity, and the training was specifically directed towards residents. And I think it's such a great, great thing. One of the interesting things in this picture, you can see Dr. John Porterfield. He's the program director down in Birmingham. But way up there in the corner, Dr. Burns would like me to point out, that's Amy Hildreth. So she's a trauma surgeon that trained here. She's now the program director in Wake Forest. And she has never and probably will never do a robotic case in her life. But she recognized that this program was so important that she wanted to bring her residents down. So she brought two residents with her from Wake Forest to have that experience. And it was a great time. We learned a lot and got a great opportunity to do some more training. Here at Erlanger, I've had an opportunity to do a robotics case with Dr. Dart, Dr. Giles, Dowden, Maxwell, Nelson, Stanley, and Dr. Jean. This video kind of shows what we're able to do. It's a lady that came in with a flank hernia after spine surgery. Flank hernias are very difficult. I know Dr. Arnold says you can never fix them, but I'd offer that maybe with robotics we can fix them. So here you can see on the right flank, the colon was inside the hernia defect. The hernia defect was small, and with the robotic camera, I've actually driven the camera into the hernia defect, looking over the colon, and then being able to mobilize the colon out of the hernia defect here. And that's something that would be very difficult to do laparoscopically. I think there's very good laparoscopic surgeons that can do these, but with the robotic technology, it really increases your dexterity. I've sped up the motion a little bit here just to get through the video. We don't actually move that fast with the robot, but here you can see outside of the hernia again, we're continuing to reduce the colon, dividing the tissues there, and preparing the defect for repair. And as the colon is just about removed here, you can see the full hernia defect. And then one of the advantages of robotics is sewing. So here you're able to actually primarily repair the defect, bring the muscles back together, which is something that's very challenging on these flank hernias. And I think it's something that the robotic technology allows us to do that I couldn't do this laparoscopically, I don't think. So we repair the defect primarily with suture, bring it completely closed. There's a special suture that has little barbs on it that prevents it from pulling back through the tissue. Measure the defect, cut a piece of mesh that's kind of like Velcro on one side, and then the mesh covers that defect. So you've closed the muscle back together with the fascia. You've covered it with mesh. It's kind of a belt and suspenders repair there. And then you don't want that mesh touching your colon. So then, again, with the technology, we're able to, I put a single stitch in it just to hold the mesh in place, just a little extra security. But then we're able to close the peritoneum over the mesh to completely cover it. And this is a case I did with Dr. Maxwell, and it was a great learning experience for me, and appreciate his patience and wisdom in letting me work through this case. So as you can see, the peritoneum gets completely closed, covers the mesh completely, and I think we had a good repair at the end of the case. So, as I said, we don't know where robotics is going. I think this is the future. This is a 15-millimeter port that has four arms, including a camera, and I think we'll see what this does. So for me, going to Roseburg, Oregon, robotics in Roseburg, that sounds crazy. But I think for a small hospital, having a robotics program will allow us to recruit good urologists, good GYN surgeons, and good general surgeons going forward, because we don't know where this technology is going to be. Inguinal hernias, flank hernias, ventral hernias, cholecystectomies, colectomies, splenectomies, cases that I've done here that I hope to take to Roseburg. We also get an opportunity to rotate on a private service. Dr. Nolan, in his book, there was a hospital in New York called North Shore, private versus public was his chapter. Here we have what we call our peer service, our C rotation. And what Dr. Nolan said is city hospitals and private hospitals are as different as night and day. Not only for patients, but for interns and residents as well. Going from Bellevue, the public hospital, to North Shore, a private hospital, was like traveling from heaven to hell, or vice versa, depending on your taste. And I think that's so true. What we do here at Erlanger, as what we would consider our public hospital compared to the hospitals, it's just different. And so this program, we get an opportunity to see both ways of practicing, and I think it's very beneficial. In my time on the peer service, I did 336 cases. I'll never forget my first month over there. I think I did 55 in 1 month as a second-year resident. And it's just you and the attending surgeon, which is such a different experience. And I think the diversity of training that we get between those two locations is very beneficial for us. And you can't talk about the peer service without talking about Dr. Arnold. I think so many of us go over there and spend so much time with Dr. Arnold, I think most of us will always remember all the learning that we've done with him. And as we go back and forth from different hospitals, we learn different teams. And I think it gives us an opportunity to see how important the operating room team is. We're, I think, blessed here with such great people in the operating room. And I think it leads to a great education. As Dr. Nolan said, every operation is a team event. A surgeon can no more operate on a patient by himself than a general can fight a war alone. So you have to have good people around you. And you have to be willing to learn from people. Because when all the team works together, when we could feel the things were going right, we shared equally in the joy of the job well done. Learning the art of surgery, I think there's no doubt that we learn from our surgeons, but I think we also learn from the people around us, the scrub techs, the circulating nurses, and they all teach us the art of surgery, because I think that's what it's all about. Is it's such a complete thing that you have to learn. It's not just a matter of can you do the operation. And I think Dr. Moore teaches us that more than anybody, that surgery is an art, and it's something that we have to learn from everybody around us and in the hospital. This is the operating room team. I got to go out to dinner with them recently, and all their kids came, our kids came, and we had a great time. And that's one thing I will definitely miss about Erlanger is the team in the operating room. So, as Dr. Nolan wrote in his book, there was no doubt about who was in charge of the surgical program at Bellevue, and that was somebody named Dr. Stevens. And I think Chattanooga is the same way. There's no doubt in anybody's mind who's in charge here, and that's Dr. Burns. And I think this quote from Dr. Halstead in 1904 sums up, I think, a lot of what Dr. Burns is trying to do in terms of getting this program where he wants it to be. And Dr. Halstead said that we need a system, and we shall surely have it, which will produce not only surgeons, but surgeons of the highest type, men and women who will stimulate the first youths of our country to study surgery and to devote their energies and their lives to raising the standard of surgical science. And I think that's what it's about. They try to recruit the best people they possibly can into surgery and surgery here in Chattanooga. And I think part of that is, as Dr. Burns says, this is a benevolent dictatorship. And I think that's important because there's no doubt on anybody's mind who's running the ship. And that, I think, gives stability. So our final year here, our chief resident, as he described it as a final responsibility, and I described it as the show. It was a job for which I had been working so long and so hard, and as elated to finally have it. But the responsibility that went with it put the fear of God into me. And I think that's a perfect quote for my year as a chief resident. It's something we've worked for so long to be, but you have to accept the responsibility of it. Orange surgery is an opportunity that our program gives that most programs do not. It's a chief-run service. Not only do we run the service in the hospital, but we also get an opportunity to run our clinic. And every Tuesday and Friday afternoons, we run a clinic, we see patients, we have specialty clinics, and get an opportunity to do a lot of different cases on that. And in those clinics, there's four surgeons that spend a lot of time with us. Dr. Arnold and Dr. Bryce run they staff the general surgery clinic. And then our specialty clinics staff mostly the breast clinic, mostly by Dr. Witherspoon and others. And then our endocrine clinic by Dr. Giles. There's also colorectal clinics, vascular clinic that the fellows in those specialties run. But these four contributed so much to our learning in the clinic, and I appreciate them for everything they've done. So your year as a chief resident, I would definitely describe as a roller coaster. And some days you feel like this. Everything is going smooth. You're just going up and down the gentle hills. Some days you feel like this. Other days, you're just mad. And then some days you feel like the whole place is on fire. But I think the year as a chief resident is something that cannot be replaced. And I think our program has done such a great job maintaining it as a true chief year. There's been a lot of talk about surgical residents finishing programs and not being ready to go out and practice. And this was a paper that looked at autonomy in surgical residency. And some of the stats in this just struck me. One of them, 86% of programs do not allow chief residents to complete the majority of a particular case without direct supervision. And I think that's ultimately the biggest change in surgical training today. Not that we need surgeons that just don't care and don't come in the operating room, but I think to be trained, you need some sort of autonomy, the opportunity to make decisions on your own, knowing that somebody's always there to call, But you have to have that opportunity to be ready to go out and practice. And this one, another, this was a survey of fellowship directors. And they felt, 21% felt that fellows were unprepared for the operating room. This one just amazed me. 30% said that the fellow, when they started, could not independently perform a laparoscopic cholecystectomy. I think, we'll look at my numbers, but I think I have something around 250 cholecystectomies in my training here. And then many fellows are pursuing fellowships to make up for poor experiences in the residency rather than to take their skills to the next level. And I think that's something that here in Chattanooga we'd say, I don't think anybody will ever say that about something that comes out of Chattanooga. Here in a talk that Dr. Burns gave, he said, there's no substitute for the operative experience in the training of a surgeon. And this area of the program assessment should remain as the top evaluation parameter of surgical residencies by the Residency Review Committee. And I think, as I said, there's no doubt that we operate here in Chattanooga. And the time that we spend in the operating room is not anything that can be replaced by simulators, skills labs. Those are great opportunities here, but there's nothing that can replace the time in the operating room, the time that we get to spend with our attending surgeons learning the art of surgery. And here is my case log. So this is as of the 1st of June. We did put on a few extra cases in June, but here you can see, so as I finish, my total number of cases, we're required to have 850, and here in Chattanooga, I had 1,547 by the 1st of June. And I think it's the diversity of the cases and the autonomy of those cases that that contributes so much more than just the number. So you can see 155 complex laparoscopic cases as opposed to the required 75. And it's that diversity of cases that we get that contributes so much to our education. So the making of the Chattanooga surgeon, at the end of the day, it really isn't about the case logs or numbers or statistics. It's really about the people that we get to work with. And it's this group of people that makes us who we are. And it's so I'm so grateful for the opportunity to have trained here in Chattanooga. And as Dr. Burns asked in his presidential address in the Southeastern Surgical Congress, where do we go from here? Well, for me, I'm going back to Roseburg, Oregon. It's a small town in Southern Oregon. I'm going to be a general surgeon, one of four surgeons there, and start my practice. And as I get ready to leave Chattanooga and leave Erlanger, my home, the place where I feel safe and I know the people and they know me, I'm reminded of another experience in my life. And this experience was one where I also left a place that I felt safe and secure. And I fell out of an airplane, and as I was falling, it was such a thrill. But then I remembered that there was a guy strapped on my back with a parachute, and that he was there to catch me and make sure I land safely. And I think that's what we have when we leave Chattanooga. We have everybody's phone number here. And I think those people, our attending surgeons, will be the parachute that I'll always have available to call and ask questions to and just say, hey, what do you think about this? And I'm very, very grateful to have those people's numbers in my cell phone. So I want to thank everybody. Thank my fellow chief residents for such a great year, and I'd be honored to have any questions.
It doesn't get much better than that. Questions, comments briefly. We have a little time. Anybody want to chime in? All right. Thank you very much, as always. Before I start this introduction, I want to recognize a couple other people to make one comment. Since nobody asked a question, I'll tell you all that 3 weeks ago I was in Chicago for the third now annual summit on surgical education, where every surgical discipline from ophthalmology to OBGYN to ENT had the chairman of the board of their respective boards, chairman of the RRCs, and president of the program directors. And the first paper, or the first presentation, everybody presents their data about where the problems are in surgical education, because everyone has a lot of the same problems that we're talking about here, that Brent has touched on, like autonomy, for example. And the chair from the University of Chicago gave one of the first presentations about general surgery, and he explained this new novel program that they have at the University of Chicago, that as the 2 days bore on, everybody referenced this about how absolutely fantastic this was and what a novel experience it was for them to be doing what they do, and the design of this program was that you had this service where the patient would come to the emergency room and they would call the resident to see the patient, and the resident would go see the patient, and the resident would evaluate the patient and decide that they might need an operation, and then they would call the faculty and tell them about it, and then they would take the patient to the operating room and operate on the patient. And the faculty would be there to help them if they needed to, but this was the design of this novel program at the University of Chicago. And David Richardson and I were sitting there together, and we did restrain ourselves reasonably about, what are you talking about? Now, they did do some things in terms of assessment and communication and so forth, but it basically it described our orange service, and of course, a lot of our private services as well, but it definitely described it. So it was nice to see, and everybody vowed that next year there were more of them were going to come back telling the same story about novel programs that they could start at their places. So made me feel good about that we have the orange service now. Again, before I introduce, I want to make a couple of other observations about people that have come in. Have Dr. Lambiasi came in, chair of medicine here. Lou, we're glad you're here. Tom Lehman came in earlier, and I want to acknowledge what a stalwart Tom has been ever since he started here as a medical student, frankly, but residency and now. And now the experience up at Athens, that is a very, again, novel program that we seem to have here. So thank you, Tom. I'm glad you're here today. And I know we're going to hear more about that from Nick later on. And then I want to be sure and recognize our fabulous dean. Stand up, Bruce. I want everybody to know who Bruce is. We finally have a surgeon as a dean. And he has had to take on a lot of controversial issues on our behalf in the last 2 years since he got here. He didn't know what he was getting into, but we're glad he did, and we're sure happy that he's here. Okay, John, if you turn the lights down, I will get around to introducing Brent Eastman, who's the 28th lecturer, McCravey lecturer. And talk a little bit about it. We're supposed to be up here.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. All right. But before we do this, and I know that the Dr. Eastman would tell you that they've been to a lot of named lectures, a whole lot of them in their life. And one of the things that's always struck me, and many of you who've been here have heard me say this over and over, and once again, you're probably tired of hearing it, but it's always mystified me that you'd have a named lecture and nobody really knows what the person whose name was used really did. So every year I tell you a little bit again about Dr. Augustus McCravey, and he had no middle name, by the way. His wife made that point very clear to me one time when I gave him a middle name. She said, he didn't have a middle name. It was Augustus McCravey, and that was it. And he was a longtime leader in this community, both medically and otherwise. He was born down in Whitestone, Georgia in 1910. Grew up there in this house that both served as a house and a country store for the people in the neighborhood, and it was close to the railroad there. He was the first person in his family to go to college and certainly to go to medical school. And then after he graduated from medical school, he came to Erlanger Hospital and did an internship and then beyond that point, went decided he wanted to do more and went to Temple University and the Temple program in Philadelphia, and was one of the first trained neurosurgeons in America. In fact, was one of the first 100 neurosurgeons in the United States. Shortly thereafter, he went in the military, and while in the military, met this lady named Helen Wells, who was a nurse from Massachusetts, and they got married the day before the Pearl Harbor attack. And then he went on to an illustrious career in the military, and she was again supportive, but then they decided to move back to Chattanooga, where he had a huge impact, started the neurosurgical group here, brought along other people with him. Dr. Bohm from New York and brought him along, actually trained him as a neurosurgeon in the process, but did a lot of things, including activities such as being a very prominent member of the Board of Trustees of this hospital. Along the way, they had a family, their two children. This is John McCravey, who's here now, in Chattanooga as a medical oncologist, and his sister, who is a pediatric intensivist in Oregon. And then this is a son-in-law who's an orthopedist in Oregon as well. So they're both UT graduates. I always show this picture. The Eastmans will appreciate this, because this is him on his farm, and he had Hereford cattle, which we very much appreciated in our family, at least, that was the case. I'd been here about a month, and he came up to me and he said, you're going to have to do me a favor. Of course, I knew he was an icon. He'd operated on my mother when I was a resident in Chattanooga, or in Memphis, and he said, you're going to have to do me a favor. And I said, what's that? I said, what could I do for you? And he said, I made a mistake when I designed the requirements for being a member of the neurosurgery group, and when you get to be 65, you have to quit practice. And I'm going to be 65 next month, and you got to find something for me to do. So at that point, we had a neurosurgery clinic, like the Orange Clinic, and so for the next 13 years, he was the attending in the neurosurgery clinic. And we didn't have any problem getting coverage from the neurosurgeons in town, because he'd call them and say, you need to do X, Y, or Z. And they basically said, yes, sir. He was a gentleman, but he was firm. And this just shows him at one of these alumni meetings before we had the McCravey Award, or McCravey Lecture, talking to Mike Greer and another resident there, and then he encouraged some people. This is Gary Gropper, who's a neurosurgeon in Atlanta. He encouraged them to get into neurosurgery as a career. Well, he was great, but he did not fund the McCravey Lecture. His estate did. His son here, John, and his mother, Helen, or his wife, Helen, funded the McCravey Lectureship 29 years ago. And John, by the way, just sent me a text during Brent's talk apologizing for not being here. And I think this may be the first year ever that either he or his mother weren't here for it. But he's at an alumni event of his own in South Alabama and couldn't be here today. But he usually is always here. So they saw to it that we funded it. Mrs. McCravey came to every lecture until about a year before she died. I happened to be at her bedside when she died, by the way. She was a marvelous lady. And she would come and bring friends of hers with her, like Harry Stone, that we all knew and loved here. And it was always a pleasure to see her, but she would always get me aside, Dr. Eastman, you won't have to have this happen, because unfortunately, she's gone, but she critiqued every McCravey lecturer, whether they were any good or not. So the McCravey family, and particularly the two of them, have been great for our community, and certainly, I think, as this shows here, that they've continued to live on. Well, our 28th McCravey lecturer is my friend Brent Eastman, and he joins a lot of famous people that Brent would know. He knows all these people, from Stan Dudrick to David Richardson to Scott Jones, and he's worked with all of them. Wayne Meredith, a good friend of his, who actually followed him about 4 years or so as the Committee on Trauma Chair. So Brent's been in good company with a lot of good people. When he took over as president of the American College of Surgeons, one of the things that he had four areas that he thought the college should work on hard, and one of them was rural surgery, because he always claimed that he was from a small town in Wyoming. Now, the population here of Wyoming was actually in 2012, so it was 12,000. He says when he grew up there that it was 3,000, and I believe him. Now, he and I happened to work together during that time of his presidency, and he'd send me off to do things different places on behalf of the college as well. And so when I started talking about the rural thing, and they would say, well, is he not from a small town? And I'd say, well, yeah, he is, but I'm from a much smaller one. Because when I grew up, I think Pikeville might have had a population of 1,500, and it hadn't grown at all. So it's basically the same place now. But we did have that opportunity to work together, and I can tell you, working with him, he's a scholar. More than anything, he's a surgeon, and everybody who ever worked with him recognizes that is his chief claim to fame, but he's been a leader and a role model for a lot of people. He did grow up in Wyoming, went to the University of Wyoming, and interestingly, as a result of contacts he made there, I think he knows personally every governor, senator, representative, an important person who lives in Wyoming to this day. Went on from there to the University of California, San Francisco for medical school, residency there, where he was with Don Trunke and a lot of other, Frank Lewis and other people that again are leaders in American surgery. For part of his time, he spent a year over in England as a special fellow over there. Along the way, I mentioned the leadership aspect of his life, and he's you see there the chief medical officer at the Scripps Health program in La Jolla, San Diego. One of the things that many of the trauma surgeons here would know, if you look at the history of organized trauma care, one of the really significant things that he did was to co-found the San Diego County Trauma System, which was a very, very hotly debated issue at the time, and maybe he'll tell you something about that, but at any rate, he was the leader of getting that done, because I happened to be involved in the Committee on Trauma at the time and was well aware of it. He was the chair of the Committee on Trauma for the period of time there when a lot of activity occurred that led to important changes in organized trauma care in the country, including the College of Surgeons setting up the Consultation Committee for Trauma Systems that would help them get developed better. He went on to be appointed to the Board of Regents of the college, and then the chair of the Board of Regents, and then president of the American College, where he was a fabulous representative for all of us. He's a member of virtually every important surgical society, including the Southern Surgical, which just goes to show you that even though he lives in Wyoming or San Diego, the Southern Surgical is a regional organization in name only, because we do include a lot of people like him in it. So we're really happy to have Brent Eastman here as our McCravey lecturer and welcome him to the podium.
Thank you very much, Phil. I can't tell you what an honor and a privilege it is to be here today. Having been here a few days, one of them spent at the Burns Farm, Tika and I have decided that Chattanooga, Tennessee is the friendliest place we've ever been in the world. And I'm going to tell you about some of the places we've been. I'm going to begin this lecture by saying, would you please leave your cell phones on? The reason I say that, in the event that I say something memorable or more likely preposterous, you're welcome to tweet and text and communicate in that way. I'm also very cognizant that Dr. Burns runs a very tight program with limits, and he told me how long I had to speak. And I remembered what my Wyoming grandmother told me one time, which was, Brent, if you're ever asked to give a speech, just remember one thing. Be sure you finish before your audience does. And I'll try to do that today. As Phil said, I went on in my career in surgery, and I so appreciated Dr. Soder's presentation, which was really a preamble to what I have to say. He said it from a much more youthful point of view, but I couldn't agree more, and I will try to emphasize how important it has been for me to be a general vascular and trauma surgeon. One other thing I did in my life that was very important from my point of view in my career was through college and medical school, I made my way and paid my way as a river guide in Jackson Hole, Wyoming. And I learned two things as a river guide. One, that whitewater was a lot like trauma surgery in that you could hear the roar ahead. In trauma surgery, of course, it was the loss of blood. And as you heard the whitewater ahead, you knew that you needed to be prepared to do something and be skillful to get through it. And over the years as a surgeon, and particularly in trauma surgery, I thought that that was a very similar situation. The second thing I learned, maybe even more important, was that I got ready every day to take some 18 people down the Snake River over and over, same moose, same eagles, same mountains, same river. It could have become boring for me and for the river guides who worked for me. But I always pointed out that for those 18 people, this was the only time they were going to be going down the river. And so we had to put our own personal view of that aside and make sure that we made it a special day for them. And I would say to the young surgeons going out into practice, that's the same way with surgery. You may have done many operations. You may have done many appendectomies, splenectomies, aneurysms, carotids. But for that patient, that's the only one they're going to have. And I think we should always keep that in mind. If I can see how to advance to my first slide, I'm not quite sure here where the... Okay. That's out of sequence.
Good.
I won't repeat what Dr. Burns said, but I too think it's important to recognize why we have the lecture that we have here today. And as I read about the honoree Augustus McGravey, it occurred to me that there's some similarities. You know, Phil, that wooden shed that you showed was about the same size as the home I grew up in Evanston, Wyoming. And you commented that a railroad passed by, and the railroad was very important in my life in Evanston, Wyoming, since my father was a railroad engineer. We've already heard his legacy, and I will not reiterate those. But I thought the fact that he stayed on after age 65, which is very young to have to retire, as a teacher and as a mentor to those of you who had the privilege of training here. But for me, the most important thing about this distinguished surgeon is that he is the honoree for today's lecture. I am going to try to do several things in the time I have today. First and foremost, I want to honor the graduating chief residents in surgery here and acknowledge, from my perspective, again, how fortunate it has been for you to have trained here. I want to give a little history, hence the title of my lecture, of your and our surgical heritage. And I'm going to explain this maybe unusual title that you've seen, Remover of Arrows. You know, what the heck does that have to do with what we're talking about today? I'm going to give just a taste of my own journey and share that with you. And then mostly I want to focus on your surgical heritage and to honor you as surgical residents. Principally through what Phil Burns has told me, I know that you are surgical stars, and I've had the opportunity to meet several of you already, and I know that to be the case. And you're taking a very diverse approach to where you're going in surgery, and I think that's wonderful. I think this speaks volumes about the program here, that you're doing everything from general private practice to specialty surgery, to military service, and all of that I think will tie in with some of the comments that I want to make. So at this point, and this is maybe the most important thing I can do today, I'd like to say congratulations to the five of you graduating chief residents, and I would also ask that your mentors, families, spouses, and partners please stand with you so that at least I can see who you all are who are here today, so we can congratulate you. Please stand. I thought perhaps the most apropos quote that I can include here was one that Courtney Townsend, a past president of the College of Surgeons, made some years ago, that when you see a turtle on a fence post, you know it had help getting there. And that's my recognition of all of you who have helped our five superstar chief residents get where they are today. I will be referencing the American College of Surgeons for obvious reasons. And although the data for 2018 are not yet compiled, I do have the data from 2017. And I was pleased to see that there was about 25% of the initiates the year that Dr. Burns and I were leading the American College of Surgeons who were female. And that is a huge change from the early days of surgery, as we know. And this gives me an opportunity. Some of you who were here yesterday heard my wife, Tika, who is a pediatrician, comment on her mother, Dr. Anita Figueredo. Anita, who was my first surgical partner, and I used to shock somewhat chauvinistic surgical audiences around the world where I would ask the question, how many of you in the audience had your mother-in-law as your first partner? And this was, I never had anybody who could comply with that. But I did operate with this incredibly talented surgeon, Anita Figueredo. She was not only a very, very talented surgeon. We all know there are people who can operate and people who can't, and she could. She also had 9 children and never stopped operating. It helped that her office was across the street from the hospital, so she could go over, do a case, go into labor, have one of her 9 children, one of whom fortunately was my wife, and then go on. And if anybody would like to know more about this amazing woman, this is my unabashed recognition of my wife, Sarita, who wrote her mother's biography, A Trail of Light. And I think it is very well written and tells the story of this amazing woman who came from Costa Rica, was raised in New York, by a non-English-speaking mother who worked in the sweatshops of the Garment District of New York. Anita went on, a very bright young woman, to her various schools. And so, and Brent, in your, you commented about the about World War II. It was actually World War II that allowed her to go on and fulfill her dream of becoming a surgeon, because after Pearl Harbor, most of the young men in the surgical training programs went to war. And Memorial Cancer Hospital in New York, later to become Sloan Kettering, had to take two women, one of whom was Anita Figueredo. So she became one of the first surgical oncologists, female surgical oncologists in the country, and then was the first woman surgeon in San Diego, California. And then a few years ago, the New York Times realized that they had failed to recognize some of the great women in history. And so they asked families of great women from New York to submit an obituary. And Tika's family did this and submitted the obituary for Anita Figueredo, was one of the famous New York City women. And here she is with her lifelong friend, Mother Teresa of Calcutta. And I will tell you a bit more about that. But the real theme of my lecture today is to hopefully have the young surgeons go out here thinking about their surgical heritage and think for a moment about a surgeon or surgeons, and we've already heard this today, who have most influenced your surgical career. Undoubtedly, I know at the top of your list will be Dr. Philip Burns, who we see here, and you all know his accomplishments better than I. When he was first vice president of the American College of Surgeons, which is where we really worked closely together, I'd got to know Phil well and had the greatest respect for a man who spoke the truth and clearly put the patient first. He was a teacher, a mentor, and I think most importantly here today for me to say is that Phil Burns is my friend and a significant part of your surgical heritage. And of course, you also stand on the shoulders of Augustus McGravy, and we should not forget that today as we give, as I have the opportunity to give this lecture in his name. And in addition to surgery, based on our experience in visiting the farm, I thought probably you've learned something about the raising of Hereford bulls in addition to surgery here in Chattanooga. So remover of arrows, where the heck does that title derive? And it actually came from Professor Takis Ballas, who was professor of vascular surgery in Athens, Greece. And when we were visiting there in the 90s, Takis gave me this slide. And I did not know this, and perhaps some of you don't, so this will be maybe a piece of information that will be new information, that the term iatros, or physician, which we all know, was first mentioned in Homer's Iliad, and it referred to the remover of arrows. Hence, I went back about as far as I could go in my own history to come up with our surgical heritage, and you'll see that I try to develop that we are all remover of arrows. While we were in Athens on that same trip, Teek and I were walking through the streets of Athens, and the only thing that was open that day was the military museum, and I did take this picture of a bronze arrowhead, which was from Homeric Troy. So I think that the Iliad did reflect accurately about remover of arrows. And the word trauma is also ancient, a statement on a piece of ancient Greek pottery. Two brothers who denied beating up a third brother, stating, "The wound you have, we ain't done it." Some of you probably will recognize that as what you've heard from some of your patients involved with trauma. And of course, one of the most famous characters in history, Saint Sebastian, the Roman Christian martyr, was shot with arrows. And as a trauma surgeon, when we were in the museum looking at this particular original painting, all I could think of was all of the various injuries that they would have had to deal with, vascular injuries, splenic injuries, liver injury, penetrating injuries, etc. And I know that Chris is going to be going on in the military, and there has always been a very strong link between war and surgery, even going back to the ancient Greeks, where the goddess of war and surgery were in fact one and the same. For the young surgeons, I hope there are two people you will remember as I develop the history of surgery. One is Ambrose Paré in the 1500s, who was in fact a French army surgeon. He was the surgeon to four kings of France. And the most important thing about Paré from my lecture today is that he revived the use of ligature instead of boiling oil for stopping bleeding. And he continued to devise and champion more humane treatments. If we think about what's happening in military, particularly in military medicine today, it was Paré in the 1500s who introduced amputation as a life-saving measure in medicine. And soon after, and this is a little-known fact about Paré, he also started developing prosthetic limbs in a scientific manner that really set the stage for what we are doing today. And I'll mention two situations where I had personal involvement with that. Here's a painting of Paré in the 1500s doing an amputation, reaching for the hot iron so that he could use cautery instead of boiling oil. And what I'll point out here is that anesthesia at that time required a stout anesthesiologist who basically held the patient down and provided restraint. The other person in history I hope you will remember from today is Dominique Jean Leray from the 1776 up to 1842. He was Napoleon's surgeon, and Napoleon considered him the worthiest man I ever met. He made several contributions to the trauma surgery. He really invented the heavy ambulance, and it was he who created the flying ambulance, which first had the concept of moving wounded soldiers from the battlefield to a field hospital, and we know that that's fundamental in the practice of medicine in the military today. It also set the stage for something I'll allude to at the end of my presentation about the C-17 flying ICUs that have been so instrumental in changing the mortality rate in trauma in both Iraq and Afghanistan. And this shows you the interior of one of those flying ICUs. We know that arrows played a big role in the Old West. This is an American Indian flint arrowhead embedded in the sternum of an enemy. And these are perhaps the original in-house surgeons. This is Old West Wyoming, and I like to think of these as surgeons who were in-house and ready to take on anything. The state of medicine at the time of doctors Eggleston and Smith was probably very similar to what we saw during the Civil War and really up until some of the most recent advances. Now, does anybody know who Alfred G. Packer is? I'll give you a hint. He was a mountain man and a cannibal. And he was a prospector who actually confessed to cannibalism during a harsh winter of 1874 in the Colorado Mountains. But that's not why I present Alfred G. Packer. It's because of politics and justice. in the Old West. And this is what I really want to share with you, was that a Colorado judge said to Alfred G. Packer after he cannibalized his fellow mountain men, "There was only six Democrats in all of Hinsdale County, and you, you man-eating SOB, you ate five of them. I sentence you to hang as a warning against further reducing the Democratic population." I worry a little bit in showing this that some of our politicians of today will adopt this in terms of trying to equalize the various political positions. And I'll state, even we too are remover of arrows. This was a patient I had in San Diego who was shot with an arrow right through the liver. And I thought, I finally qualify as a remover of arrows. And another example of trauma in history, Teke and I were driving home from a production of, a particularly fine production of Hamlet one night in San Diego. And of course, all I could think of is, boy, that was really trauma. And if you all remember Hamlet, you'll know that to be the case. Also arrows, the famous to be or not to be, that is the question, whether it's nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune or to take arms against a sea of troubles and by opposing end them. So you can see why, as a trauma surgeon driving home that night, probably having been on trauma call the night before, I was impressed with Hamlet as really being a study in trauma. And being interested in trauma systems, it occurred to me that of the 10 principals and 9 deaths, only Horatio was left standing, so that 6 out of the 9 deaths were preventable had Shakespeare chosen to have a trauma surgeon involved in Hamlet, which of course he did not. And I always enjoyed this cartoon where the doctor says, "It's got to come out, of course, but that doesn't address the deeper problem." And perhaps Shakespeare was addressing a deeper problem with Hamlet. And then a little on the lighter side, recently Teke and I were in San Francisco for a surgical meeting and saw this 60-foot steel and fiberglass sculpture on the San Francisco Embarcadero. It was apparently inspired because of San Francisco's reputation as the home port of Eros, the god of love. By the way, it was San Francisco in the 1960s when we were there in training that we met over a cardiac arrest due to a tension pneumothorax. That's a story I won't tell now, but would be happy to discuss it with any of you who are interested in pneumothoraces later. Had a happy ending. My reference to remove arrows will be a little more clinical. Now, there are two innovations in the 1800s that forever changed the practice of surgery. And Dr. Soder really alluded to those in his talk already. One is general anesthesia, and one is antisepsis. If we look at general anesthesia, it wasn't until 1846 in the Ether Dome in Boston that Dr. Morton, the dentist, administered general anesthesia to his patient with a tumor of the jaw, and Dr. John Collins Warren, surgeon at the Mass General, removed this with perhaps the first painless surgery. I would just ask you to compare that with our friend Ambrose Paré in the 1500s, where anesthesia was restraint and required holding the patient down, in this case, while an amputation was done. And the second is antisepsis. So we have general anesthesia on one hand and antisepsis. Lord Lister, who's sometimes called the father of modern surgery, was the third Regius Professor of Clinical Surgery at the University of Edinburgh. And fortuitously, Lister communicated with Louis Pasteur in Paris and learned early on about the germ theory that Pasteur was postulating. And Lister's great contribution was taking the concept of the germ theory and sepsis and bringing it into surgical practice. At that time, his practice was to put carbolic acid into wounds and forever revolutionized the practice of surgery. I want to make sure you have these dates in mind. He first published his work on antisepsis in 1867. And as you see, that was just after the Civil War. And the wonderful lecture we heard yesterday, many of those deaths and the mortality of those horrendous battles during the Civil War would have been prevented had the concept of antisepsis been in the practice at that time. We also had the pleasure of, when we visited Edinburgh, of meeting Professor O. James Garden, who is the current Regius Professor of Surgery at the Royal Infirmary in Edinburgh, under a portrait of Lord Lister. And Professor Garden was chosen to deliver the University of Edinburgh centennial lecture celebrating the 100th year after Lister's death, called Lister's Legacy, 100 Years and On. And he recounted in this lecture many of those things which I have alluded to. There are two very famous paintings that you may be familiar with, but that I never recognized what they really represented. This is the Gross Clinic in Philadelphia, painted by Thomas Eakins in 1875. And you see the horrified wife of the young man having an amputation with no antisepsis. And then we have the painting of the Agnew Clinic in Philadelphia several years later by the same artist. And what I had never recognized till I did the research for this lecture was that Eakins had unwittingly painted the evolution from sepsis, as you see in the portrait, with the Gross Clinic, to antisepsis in the Agnew Clinic. And here is the surgical historical fact. Again, I'm sure many of you are aware of, but if not, you should be, that U.S. President James Garfield was shot in the back in 1881 and died 80 years later of sepsis because Dr. Gross, who many of you know founded our American Surgical Association, had not adopted Lister's proof of antisepsis in his surgical technique or teaching. And rather than observing what Lister had known, President Garfield was examined by every surgical specialist in the area who, with an ungloved hand, probed the back wound to try to find the bullet. And that led to Garfield dying of sepsis due to this gross misuse of the antiseptic technique. Now, each of you graduating today, and I'm really talking to the five chief residents and their families, has your own story. And I'm going to encourage you, we've seen the surgical log, which is wonderful. That's a relatively new innovation. But I would always so encourage you to write down, handwritten or in the electronic medical narrative, whatever you can do, some of the special cases you've had, some of the special patients you've had, because later on in your career, I think you will be happy to remember them. A bit of my own journey. I commented that this little house, and yes, Phil, the population was 3,000, I think is probably about the same size as the shack that our honoree was born in. And Evanston, Wyoming, I like to point out, had a trauma system, but it was different than what we know today. It was my Uncle Gilbert, who was the undertaker, the county coroner, the Boy Scout first aid course teacher, and his greatest possession was this 1951 Cadillac Combo Hearst ambulance. And he was, as I say, both the county coroner and also chairman of the hospital board. And Gilbert, I interviewed his son later, and he said that occasionally they would have a funeral in process and be delivering the casket to the cemetery when they would get a trauma call. And so they would stop, offload the casket at the roadside, and proceed to the scene of the trauma. And Royce, Gilbert's son, said, it was always very disconcerting for the rancher when we drove up in the ambulance because they didn't know if Gilbert was there as the mortician or as the ambulance service. And they knew he had a conflict of interest when he hit the outskirts of Evanston, Wyoming, whether he was going to go left to the hospital or right to the mortuary. Another event that really influenced my life was this train wreck outside of Evanston, Wyoming. My father was a railroad engineer, and this was one of the worst train accidents in the history of the Union Pacific Railroad. And my father took me out to see this wreckage. And the incredible thing about this was that many of the passengers on the city of San Francisco, which crashed into the rear end of the city of Los Angeles in a snowstorm that obscured the block signals that should have made them stop. Many of the passengers on the city of San Francisco were in fact surgeons returning from San Francisco to the Clinical Congress where they had just attended. So I wrote the college. And Rollo Hanlon sent me, he said, you're in good luck, Brent, because this is the original program from that clinical congress. And in fact, I said, I did this for the Scudder Oration, which is the trauma lecture I was giving. I said, what was the Scudder Oration that year of the train wreck? And in fact, it was fortuitously an oration on fractures by Reginald Watson Jones. And so clearly, many of the surgeons who survived, many died in this train wreck, had just several days before in San Francisco heard an erudite lecture about the management of fractures by one of the leading orthopedic surgeons in the world, Sir Reginald Watson Jones from London. And what was observed that they would take orange crates out of the food car and fashion splints for the broken limbs of the people who were the survivors of this incredible crash. Now, I want to say a word in terms of my own history about my mentors, which I reflect on, and we've already heard this today about how important this is. They were Jangelbert Dumphy, who was the chair of the Department of Surgery in San Francisco, F. William Blaisdell, who was chair of trauma, and Edwin J. Wiley, who was chief of vascular surgery. But as important, or more important than that, I want the five graduating chief residents to recognize and remember and cherish the relationship with your colleagues. Phil has alluded to some. I was fortunate for these four people, three people, to be the quartet that I rotated through the San Francisco General with, George Sheldon, Frank Lewis, and Don Trunke. And I certainly, throughout my career, valued and was able to call upon them for advice, recommendations, whether it was personal, professional, or otherwise. We were in San Francisco in the 1960s, which, needless to say, was an interesting time. with the peace marches, with the Grateful Dead. If you've ever seen the movie Bullet, it was actually filmed at the San Francisco General Hospital. And somebody once said that if you remember San Francisco in the 60s, you weren't there. We were there, and we were sort of entrenched in the San Francisco General Hospital, which is very much like this hospital in that it was one of the first great public hospitals, and it's where I felt that I really grew up and learned both the art and the science of surgery. It's been said to be nice to those you meet on the way up because you will meet them on the way down. Now, most importantly, about your surgical heritage, and I've never seen a happier photograph than this, I'm going to take the opportunity and the prerogative of lending some advice, which I think you can do in this kind of a lecture, and encourage you as young surgeons early in your career to get involved with the American College of Surgeons. In my presidential address, which happened to be on the anniversary of the College of Surgeons, I compared the first 100 years and where we were going, similar to what Dr. Burns alluded to, where do we go from here? And I think that these two pictures, like those two paintings, tell a great story. Franklin Martin, who founded the College of Surgeons in approximately 1913, operating, compared to a picture in my own hospital of a laparoscopic surgical procedure being done by a woman surgeon today. It speaks volumes about the changes. And I want you, if nothing else today, the young surgeons, to come out of here thinking about your proud surgical heritage here at Erlanger. And you have Dr. McGravy, Dr. Burns, and I would put them at the top of the list of these iconic surgeons that we all know about, Evarts Graham, Harvey Cushing, neurosurgeon, Cryo Mayo Halstead, who we've heard about, Dumphy, and many others. But cherish and remember your own surgical history. I mentioned four things in my presidential address that I thought was a call to action. And with regard to access, Ildi Britt, who I know has given this lecture in the past, once said, "There is no quality without access." And as I look at where you all are going and what you're doing as the graduating residents, I think you're going to address the issue of access very well, and there's no question about the quality that you're going to bring forward. There are barriers to access in the United States. It's geography, distance, weather, terrain, and one of my colleagues, Art Kellerman, formerly from Emory, once said, "Outcomes in surgery may be more dependent on your area code than your genetic code." This is a cartoon, but sad but true. Unfortunately, your plan covers only doctors who could possibly help you in any way. And I think to the young surgeons, you are going to have to help solve some of these disparities and issues that exist in our healthcare systems today. These are data from Buzz Cooper from the University of Pennsylvania, several years old, which show a significant projected deficit in the number of surgeons and physicians in this country. But I felt compelled to provide something more updated. So I contacted Carrie Slatos, who's a senior congressional lobbyist for the American College of Surgeons in Washington, D.C., and she provided these data, which are the most recent data we have at the College of Surgeons, and that is that there will be a shortfall between 33,800 and 72,700 non-primary care physicians. including 20 to 30,000 surgical specialists shortfall. I mention that only to say that as you leave here from your surgical training, you absolutely will be needed. And I asked Kerry if any of you wanted more details. There are several really detailed studies from which I've just summarized. She said she'd be very happy to talk to any of you, provide these data if any of you care to look into it in more detail. Now, this is to me one of the most important maps I've ever seen. This was generated by George Sheldon and Tom Ricketts at the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill. And what they did was a study of the number of surgeons by county. And the big circles mean there's a lot of surgeons. The small circles mean there's not very many surgeons. And no circles mean no surgeons. So I was aware of these data from George Sheldon, one of my fellow residents. And if you look at Tennessee, you see that the large circles tend to be centered around the areas that I'm sure would not surprise you. And then I saw this map when I was involved with the grant review committee at the Center for Disease Control. And this was a map hanging on the wall that Lee Annist had produced. And I said, Lee, what is that map? And he said, well, it's very interesting, but we don't know what to do with it. It is the death rate per 100,000 from motor vehicle crashes in the United States by county. And as you see, red is bad, blue, better. When I first looked at it, I thought it was the election returns from the last year. Interestingly, it maps that rather nicely. So what I decided to do for my Scudder oration was to see if the cartographers who I knew at Johns Hopkins could superimpose and do an overlay of these two maps. They did that for me. And what you see is that where we have surgeons, the death rate is lower. Where we don't have surgeons, the death rate for motor vehicle crashes is higher. And this is the superimposition of those maps. And I thought this was very striking about the importance of surgery and the distribution of surgeons in this country. Dr. Chang in San Diego wanted to go on and do a little more sophisticated analysis of those data, and we did that in this paper. And it confirmed, where we did a regression analysis, that the higher density of surgeons is associated with significant reduction in deaths from motor vehicle crashes. And what I would like to say today, I believe this is to be true not only for trauma, but really for all major surgical diseases. And perhaps one of you young surgeons would want to go on and look at the distribution of surgeons and outcomes for surgical emergencies in general, not just for motor vehicle crashes. Rural surgery I have always been interested in, having grown up in a very rural state of Wyoming. I put this in for Dr. Burns. He showed me his Hereford bulls, and I want to show him my bull elk. This is the meadow of our home in Jackson Hole, Wyoming, with a bull elk jumping over the buck and rail fence to move on to greener pastures on the other side. I did my own survey of the graduates the year that Dr. Burns and I were leading the American College of Surgeons in 2012-2013, and 76% of the initiates that year were going to urban America, only 5% to rural. So I congratulate those of you who have the courage and I think the foresight to go into a part of the country that really needs you. This was a study that I was involved in by the Institute of Medicine, where we looked at emergency care in the United States. Interestingly, on this very large Institute of Medicine committee, there were only two, it was mostly emergency physicians, and only Bill Schwab and I were on there as surgeons. And I think our contribution was that to address the issue of emergency care in the United States, we needed trauma systems. David Richardson, who I know is a good friend of Dr. Burns and also has given this lecture, was instrumental when he was chair of the Board of Regents in looking at rural surgery and really creating a new advisory council for neurosurgery, the first new one since 1988, and that had been vascular surgery. Surgical education, which has been alluded to today already, I was impressed at Keith Lillimo's forum at the American Surgical in Philadelphia in 2017, where he had a panel, and one comment from Lord Darcy from London that I thought was very relevant, where he asked the question, are the residents, the trainees in surgery coming out today, are they ready? And he did a survey in Great Britain and concluded that there is more to surgery than just surgical skills. Failure of surgeons in their first 3 years of practice in the UK is usually due to problems with communication and interpersonal skills, not technique. Shakespeare, I alluded to Hamlet earlier, but he has given us many wise things to think about, including, have more than thou showest, speak less than thou knowest. I think that's been imparted to you here in Chattanooga. But perhaps more to the point, as Mark Twain said, it ain't what you don't know that gets you into trouble, it's what you know for sure that just ain't so. The residency issues, and Dr. Burns is more of an expert on this than I and is addressing this at a national level, but there's been a lot of discussion about whether people coming out of training are prepared or not. But the thing I've learned in coming to Chattanooga is that surgical volume is not a problem with the program that you are graduates of here. And there is a great quote that I think reflects this. Every system is perfectly designed to get the results it gets. And I think you've gotten the results that you want here by creating a program not only with surgical volume, but with autonomy. More data about the problem of reduced opportunity for autonomy and individual decision making. But I will just reiterate from my point of view that autonomy and independent decision making are critical in training young surgeons. And as we've already heard today, and as I have learned, you are very fortunate to have trained at University of Tennessee, Chattanooga, where you have had both autonomy, surgical volume, and great mentorship. Dr. Burns has made many contributions to American surgery, but I think this by Dr. Burns and Dr. Richardson is one of the really fine ideas of the transition to practice program. And it would be carrying coals to Newcastle for me to dwell on that. I think you, as young surgeons going out, must address surgical training and education. You have had the opportunity to train where you've had surgical volume, where you've had autonomy, and you have to be a voice of reason for people developing surgical training systems of the future as you go forward. I just want to mention the last one in the Department of Education at the American College of Surgeons, which is Dr. Burns' committee on coaching the next generation, which is all about whether senior surgeons, after they retire, as Augustus McGravy did, have something to offer in terms of mentoring, teaching, first assisting, whatever it is. And that committee, which I have the privilege of serving on, is really wrestling with those ideas now. These are some of the programs that the College of Surgeons is involved in. And then I want to make the point that the American College of Surgeons has always been an international organization. If you look at this map, these are the countries around the world where the American College of Surgeons has chapters. And in 2012, 2013, when Dr. Burns and I were sitting on the podium of the new initiates, it was remarkable to me then, and it still is today, that 31% of those new fellows of the American College of Surgeons were international fellows, as you see here. Tom Friedman wrote, "The world is flat," and I would admonish you that it's getting even flatter when we think about the fact there are more cell phones than toilets or toothbrushes in the world today. I interviewed Haile Dabbas at the University of California, San Francisco, former chair of Department of Surgery and former chancellor, and he said something I thought very prophetic. He's interested in global health. And he said, "Brent, we should have a diplomacy of health, that if it were healthcare and particularly surgery around the world that linked us, we would have less problems than we have today." These were some of the countries that Tika and I had the opportunity to visit during our travels with the College of Surgeons. And the point I want to make, this was our trip to Edinburgh, and although there's pageantry and honorary degrees and so on, they always ask you what you want to do when you're visiting. And I said two things I wanted to do. One, I wanted to go to the operating room, and this is going to the operating room and watching a liver transplant at the University of Edinburgh. And the other thing, I always wanted to have a private meeting with the residents, and I always did, and I always learned something. And I just want to say to the young graduating surgeons today, the problems were the same. They talked about surgical education, they talked about the need for volume, they talked about the need for autonomy, they talked about the need for flexibility, that they did not like limited work hours in surgery. They thought to interrupt the continuity of care really interrupted their education. So whether it was Edinburgh or Beijing or Tokyo or Auckland, New Zealand, the residents seemed to be very similar around the world in what they wanted and expected from surgery. We had a chance to visit with some of the leaders of other surgical organizations, such as Norman Williams and the College of Surgeons. Lord Bernie Ribeiro, standing under his portrait at the Royal College of Surgeons of England. And this meeting, which we hosted in Washington, D.C., of the presidents of all of the major colleges of surgeons around the world. And I think the thing I was struck by in all of these meetings and all of these travels is that we are wrestling with the same kind of issues worldwide, and we need to come up with international solutions. The Latin phrase at the bottom of our seal, which of course is Aesculapius and an American Indian, is to serve all with skill and fidelity. If we do nothing else but put the patient first, Mark Twain once said, "Do what is right, you will please some of the people, and you'll astonish the rest." And I think you have been imbued with that here in Chattanooga very well, to do what is right, and particularly to do what is right for your patients. I'll conclude with comments about a couple of experiences I've had outside of the United States. We did take a team to Haiti after the earthquake, about 12 days after the earthquake, and had the opportunity to staff a hospital in Port-au-Prince, which had been totally demolished by the earthquake. And one of the best things about that was that we were there with Tom Scalia and Sharon Henry from Maryland Shock Trauma, and we set up a joint service. I don't know where in the United States we would have ever had the opportunity for Scripps and Maryland Shock Trauma to run a common unit together, but Dr. Shackford and I did have that opportunity. And one of the things I want to point out that was particularly poignant was that building right there was a pediatric unit. It collapsed, and there were over 300 children, nurses, families entombed in that building. And the stench of death was so great that you couldn't get near that area of the campus. You see the scrub sink, which was rather rudimentary as well. And I've circled the most important piece of equipment that I only put in at the last minute, probably being from Wyoming and a river guide and mountain climbing, and that was my headlamp, because we had no light for our surgical procedures. So my headlamp was the saving grace for operating in Haiti. And I do want to make the point that the management of trauma, and if we go back to the beginning, the remover of arrows, has been mainly learned in wars, whether it's the Civil War, which you're very familiar with here, on around to the current situation in Iraq, Afghanistan, and the Middle East. I did have the opportunity to go to the Landstuhl Regional Medical Center in Germany as a visiting surgeon in 2007. And I'm just going to tell one story. You know, we remember how many cases we've done, but it's individual patients' stories that really reflect on our career. The night I got to Landstuhl, Germany, I was told that there was a C-17 coming in with 12 casualties, one of whom was a young Marine with bad vascular injuries, and would I take care of him, because it was a kind of an injury that I had been very interested in. And so that was the night that I met William Gatsby. He was a young Marine. His life had actually been saved by the corpsman who put a tourniquet on in the kill zone. He was then operated on in a forward surgical unit where he had a completion amputation above the knee of the right leg and a shunt in his left superficial femoral artery, which had been shattered. He then went on to a combat support hospital in Balad, where he had more formal repair of his superficial femoral artery on the left, completion of the amputation on the right. And within 23 hours, he was transferred to the Landstuhl Regional Medical Center, where I happened to be on duty that night just as a visiting surgeon, and operated on William Gatsby that night and then multiple times in the next week or two. This is the transport system between what they refer to in the military, Chris would know this, is downrange to Landstuhl, Germany, and then to the United States, or CONUS, Continental United States. If you were Army, you went to Walter Reed. If you were Marines, you went to Bethesda, Maryland. And if you had burns, you went to San Antonio, Texas. This is the interior of one of those flying ICUs. And you remember it was Jean-Claude Leray who invented this way back in the Napoleonic Wars. So William Gatsby, who I operated on, ended up in San Diego doing rehab. And I got a call from the Admiral saying, we have a young Marine here who said that you are his surgeon and that you would come and see him. So I went right down to the Balboa Naval Hospital to see William Gatsby. And his mother was there, who I met. And fortunately, we exchanged email addresses. And then I subsequently got this email, which I will cherish forever. I wanted to share with you William's marriage. He was hiking, yes, hiking in the Appalachian Mountains, it turned out, met his wife, Tatiana, who was Russian. She lives in Virginia, and William followed her there. After the baby is born, they hoping to move back to San Diego. July 21st is the day exactly 2 years ago when William was injured in Iraq. Amazing, this is the day his son will be born. And I was so pleased that they included me in this, including, I said, well, I definitely want to see pictures of this. So these are the pictures that came of Kyle Gadsby, William holding his new son. And I invited William Gadsby to come to my Scudder oration, and I asked his permission to tell a story, and he said that I could. So he came. The first thing that happened, I was all ready to give my lecture, and there was no Kyle or no William Gadsby there. And then he came running down the aisle with his above-knee prosthesis, and he apologized. And typical Marine, he said, sir, I'm so sorry I'm late, sir, but these people walk so slowly in the Chicago Convention Center that I could barely get here. And he sat with Tika and my daughter. And the thing I'll never forget is at the end of my lecture, William said, Dr. Eastman, sir, my wife and I are having a problem. And I thought, oh, no. And we would like your advice. And I said, what's the problem? And he said, well, we both agree that we want Kyle, his new son, to be a surgeon like you. And I was very proud of that. And I said, well, what's the problem? And he said, well, my wife thinks that Kyle should go to medical school first and then become a Marine. And I think he should definitely become a Marine and then go to medical school. So we want your opinion. And with no hesitation, I said, William, I think he should be a Marine first, because if he develops the strength of character that I've seen in you as a patient, he will be a better surgeon, and character is all important. He said, thank you very much, sir. I'll convey that to my wife. And she said to ask you one other thing. Would you mind writing a letter of recommendation for him for medical school? So William will always be one of my favorite patients. And I mentioned this yesterday, but it was while I was there at Landstuhl Regional Medical Center that Brigadier General Rubenstein came over and shared this quote with me, which hangs in his office as a brigadier general, that the only victor in war is medicine. So let me conclude by just several thoughts. One is, I encourage you to get involved with the American College of Surgeons, either at a local level, at a national level, or as I've alluded to, maybe even at an international level. Stay involved with your University of Tennessee Department of Surgery, surgical mentors, and colleagues. And finally, maintain a balance between work, family, and social life. Always remember you are a surgeon, those of you who are graduating, and build your life around that surgical career, but include your family and let them share the joy of that with you. Get involved with the College of Surgeons. Confucius said, tell me and I will forget. Show me and I may remember, but involve me and I will understand. That's why I encourage you to get involved. Something else that I've learned, and you will learn very quickly, you will become the consultant for your friends and family. And the connections you make through the College of Surgeons and through the University of Tennessee will provide an invaluable referral network in today's complex healthcare system. So as you become the consultant for your friends and family, as well as your patients, in our family, it's amusing, with my wife being a pediatrician, we get a call from our children regarding their grandchildren, and they'll say, "Hi, Dad, is Mom there?" And I'll say, "Yes, what's going on?" "Well, we have a medical question." And of course, that goes right to her because she knows more about medicine than I do. And I encourage you to stay involved with the University of Tennessee in Chattanooga. And then I hope you'll heed this counsel. Never hesitate to seek counsel, whether it's difficult cases, whether it's personal problems. And something that Dr. Burns and I heard at a lecture in Chicago recently, get a trusted financial advisor early on. This will benefit you and your family. And to the young surgeons, get affordable disability insurance while you're young, and it is affordable. The amazing statistic was that 60% of doctors over 65 will have long-term disability. And by that time, it's too late to get disability insurance. So if you take nothing else from my lecture, but one of the first things you do is get a trusted financial advisor as you go forward, I think it will stand you in very good stead. John Wooden, basketball coach at UCLA, once said, "Things turn out best for those who make the best of the way things turn out." With regard to work, and this is a piece of advice I have given our children, I've given residents, I've given medical students, is that there will be adversity in your lives as you go forward. But always remember, adversity does not create character. Adversity reveals character. It's been said that happy surgeons produce the highest quality work, and I believe that. So find a niche, find what you do well, do it, and enjoy what you do as surgeons as you go forward. As a friend and colleague of mine, Steve Shackford, I showed a picture of Steve when we were together in Haiti, said, "Remember your kids, don't read your CV." And this was his shortcut to a work-life balance formula. And then I'm going to give you another piece of advice, which is to consider recording moments in your life, work in surgery, whether it's in the electronic case log or whether it's the electronic health record, whatever it is. Take a moment after a special case, a special patient, and write it down or dictate it or have it for future reference. The only time I really did this, because I had to do it, to document my caseload the year I was in England, and that is a treasured document now to go back and look at the cases I did, who the patients were, what the outcomes were my year in England. So we must strike a balance if we're going to be happy surgeons. And one other, when Anita Figueredo gave my mother-in-law, surgeon, gave a commencement address, she quoted Mother Teresa of Calcutta. And maybe this will resonate with you, with your families here today. "We don't have to look across the world to find those most in need of our love and concern. They can often be found sitting across from us at the breakfast table." So the balance in my life has been my family, a more formal portrait above that was taken at the College of Surgeons during my presidential dinner, and below at our home in Jackson Hole, Wyoming, gathered on our steps outside of the property where you saw the bull elk. And hanging on the entrance to my office is this, from my daughter, Allie. "My father didn't tell me how to live. He lived and let me watch him do it." And that has been a guideline for me throughout my life, to know that my kids were watching me and that was perhaps the most important thing I could do was to live in a way that would honor them. And I'll say in closing that my greatest wish for all of you graduating chief residents at this program is the joy of a life in surgery that has been mine. You will have a very different life in surgery than I had, but surgery is always about being in the operating room, taking care of patients, doing a good operation, and seeing the outcome. So I hope that you will enjoy that in your careers. And I thank you for the privilege of giving this lecture. Thank you very much.
Dr. Eastman, this was wonderful. As always, the talks you give are, and we appreciate you being here and taking part in our festivities, including we're going to have you make a few comments maybe tonight, and we'll honor you further there. We're going to take about a 10-minute break and then get started, but only 10 minutes, okay, so we can get people out and play golf this afternoon.
Good.
Great job.
I hope that's okay.
Oh.
Thank you.
I can see the cerebral input from your wonderful wife as well.
Yeah, yeah, her voice is often heard.
It's often there, yeah. Oh, that was great. That was really good. Really.
I want to do something real quick. No, I just didn't know. I just switched it off there. John, I think that the reason that some didn't work is because we didn't switch over. So now that we're here,
okay.
Like I played the sound. I don't want it to be too loud because one of them is actually like a.
Is it turned on?
Yes.
Oh, the antennas. Well,
is this it right here?
That is it. And just pull that out. Hopefully that'll do it. Should have pointed at the antenna. So. Okay. Nothing could possibly go wrong.
Thank you. found that it really worked out.
Thank you. This stands it right here. They have to hit the slides for them. Next slide, please. Always drives me crazy when people do that. Next slide, please. Somebody's pushing their buttons for them.
It's usually because something's malfunctioning.
Right, that's right. Well, some people got it down to where they have it set on the timer. They're so good at talking. Oh. Maybe there's a setting on PowerPoint where you can slide the advance at a certain time when you slide. That's way beyond.
That's way. That's very practiced.
Yes.
Maggie, tell them to come on in. No.
Like bird and cats.
Maggie, just wanted you to tell them to come in. We can get everyone back in, find a seat. If we get everybody to get a seat, we'll get started again, please. We want to get started again in the interest of time. I know everyone is enjoying visiting. I would too. It would be nice if this break could be an hour, but then we won't get people out in time to do the things they want to do this afternoon. So. We'll get started back again. Our next resident talk about Chris Bell. And Chris is a University of Tennessee graduate. He's a Chattanooga native, went to high school here and then to medical school down at University of Tennessee and worked with us actually before he went to medical school as a second assistant up in surgery. So we knew Chris from the time he was a college student and knew that he had great promise from that exposure to him. So we've really enjoyed having Chris here with us. He finished the trauma critical care fellowship while he was a resident. So he's now double board eligible. And as Dr. Eastman has already indicated, is going to be going in the Army. He did a military commitment during medical school, and will have a stint there. He's interested in doing some research while he's in the military, and we know he's going to plan to do that. He already has a plan in mind. But it's been a pleasure always to know Chris now for a long time, since we date back to college. Again, we look forward to him. He's going to bring us something that's a little more surgically oriented, perhaps. But Chris, we look forward to this, and know you're going to go on and do great things as well.
Good morning. We'll switch gears here a little bit and get a little bit more academic and talk about doing more with less. And, you know, for all facets of surgery, you could say that we're getting to a point where we're doing more with less, from breast disease to gastric surgery. And today we're going to mainly focus on the critical care side of things and how we're getting by doing more with less. I don't have any financial disclosures, but I will disclose that this is what I like to call EBB or EBO, which is evidence-based bias or evidence-based opinion. It is faceted in a whole host of evidence. And we'll just kind of take our way down through the body, neurocognitive, some pulmonary things, hematologic, some renal issues, infectious disease, finish up with IV fluids, and along the way talk about some nutrition aspects of critical care. We'll first start with the neurocognitive side of things and look at sedation and how we've evolved to decrease the amount of sedation we use and the types of sedation. This first study we're looking at here is it talks about daily interruption of sedation. For most of the people, the residents in the room, this is standard of practice, and you know, recognize this as something we do every day. But you know, in the past, this wasn't standard of care. So they looked at 128 patients in the medical ICU, and they were either given Versed or propofol infusions along with morphine infusion for pain control. And they had daily sedation breaks, and they had to do three of the following. They had to open their eyes, track with their eyes, squeeze a hand or stick out a tongue, just basic following of commands while intubated. And as you can see between the two variables, the intervention group and the control group, there's no real statistical difference between all of categories. You know, it's usually the young male, and the Apache score was 20 to 22. So these are pretty sick patients. Just kind of put a perspective of what the Apache 2 score is. An Apache score of about a 20 is your 65-year-old guy that comes in with a perforated colon and has acute kidney injury, someone that's at about an Apache score of 20 to 25. So when they broke it down, is they designed the study to, they would do these sedation vacations, the intervention group, and then the control group was just kind of standard of care at the time. They showed that there was a significant decrease in the duration of mechanical ventilation from 7.3 to 4.9 days. And then likewise, once you were off mechanical ventilation, that decrease in the intensive care unit went from almost 10 days to down to 6 days. Pretty substantial decrease. What's even more happening is a volume of Versed that the patients received. And that went from 425 milligrams total dose, that's a lot of Versed, to about 230. And the total dose of morphine was significantly less as well. You know, this has a lot to do with how often they were weaning, but mainly because they were getting extubated sooner and not requiring as much narcotics and sedation. So when looking at this further, they broke it down into propofol and Versed, and there wasn't a statistical difference in the amount of propofol. But there was in the Versed group, and that kind of led people to decide, hey, we need to look at Versed in particular as a drug in itself. So along those lines, a new drug came on the market, dexmedetomidine, also known as Presidex, and they compared Presidex and Versed. This is a pretty impressive study, 68-center prospective double-blinded randomized controlled trial. They included almost 400 patients that were on the ventilator for greater than 24 days. And they looked at sedation and delirium determined by a RAS scale. And just to kind of refresh your memory, what that is this is the RAS scale, and it's kind of where most of us would want to be if we were intubated, probably in the -1 to -2 category, drowsy or light sedation. Most of us wouldn't want to be in the +1, but that is included. And then standard doses of Presidex, and they were titrated to achieve that goal. You know, when we look at all these studies, we try to focus on how this affects us in our practice, and how a lot of these are studies in the critical care revolve around medicine patients, but, you know, always look to the surgical ICU patients and the surgical patients within these studies, and about 13 to 15% of the patients were surgical ICU patients. Again, the two study groups, Presidex versus Versed, there was no statistical difference between the groups. They were matched accordingly and lined up very well. So they found that the duration of study drug treatment was about a half a day less with the Presidex versus the Versed, and it was 3.7 days of time to extubation versus 5.6 days. So they were decreasing by almost 2 days of extubation when they were using Presidex along with the Versed. The incidence of delirium, which was one of the main outcomes that they wanted to look at, was significantly lower, with 50% of the patients being delirious in the Presidex group versus 76% in the midazolam or Versed group. And just this data in a nice, pretty picture, this is the time from the start of the drug to time to extubation. You can see that they start off at the same level, and Presidex kind of sets itself apart from the Versed as the days go on. And then the ICU discharge on the right is showing the same benefit of using Presidex versus Versed. When they looked specifically at the prevalence of delirium, I thought this was pretty powerful. The amount of delirium at baseline at the enrollment, you know, some of the people in the Presidex arm actually had Versed prior to starting the study, and their incidence of delirium was equivocal at the beginning of enrollment. And then, as you can see, that the delirium significantly decreased with Presidex versus Versed. And I think that's we've seen a giant transition at the time that I've been here at this hospital in the ICUs, that the decrease in the amount of benzodiazepines that we use for sedation and the increase in Presidex as it's become cheaper to use. So what about the side effects? You know, we're always worried about the side effects of medication. The Presidex group did have a significant amount of, more significant amount of bradycardia. However, the Versed group had a significant amount of tachycardia. You can make what you want of this data, and my own personal bias is that tachycardia is bad in the ICU, and, you know, having maybe a little bit of bradycardia is not such a bad thing. And, like, you know, with the longer durations of sedation and delirium and length of stay, the number of infections was significantly higher, almost double, 20% versus 10% of infections. They did not show any statistical difference in 30-day mortality, but in a population like this, it's a difficult variable to look at. This is Lillian up on the helipad. She came to visit us one day and having a good time. So I'd be remiss if I gave a talk on doing more with less in critical care if I did not include this paper. This is the ARDS-NET trial, which is essentially standard of care now, with 2000 New England Journal of Medicine. It was a multi-center randomized clinical trial of almost 900 patients. They looked at low tidal volumes on the ventilator versus high tidal volumes. Traditionally, tidal volumes of 10 to 15 mLs per kg, which seems crazy to us now. And their primary outcome was looking at death before the patient was discharged home and breathing without assistance. And they had a secondary primary outcome was the number of days without the ventilator use from 1 to 28 days, which a lot of these studies have. So with our traditional arm, we had tidal volumes of 12 mLs per kg of predicted body weight with plateau pressures less than 50. They tried to keep that high, keep the plateau pressures less than 50. And then the low tidal volume group is initial tidal volume of 6 mLs per kg with a plateau pressure of around 30. And just to review what the plateau pressure is, it's essentially an inspiratory hold between the peak pressure and the varying degrees of how close the plateau pressure is to the peak pressure and how high those are references the compliance of the lung. So the higher the plateau pressure is, as close to the peak pressure as you have decreased compliance. So the lower the plateau pressure, the better the compliance of the lung and better you're going to oxygenate in most cases. They excluded a lot of patients, children, pregnant, sickle cell, bad cirrhotics, terrible burns, and probably what we would have a hard time discrediting here in our population here is a patient that weighed 1 kg per centimeter height. We don't know if we would be able to collect many patients if we excluded those here. So they found that if you look at the graph on the left, the lower tidal volumes in the dark line, the traditional tidal volumes in the dotted line, the top two curves are survival. And you can see that there was an increased survival seen between the patients. And then the bottom two lines are discharge and how patients that made it out. And you could see that it kind of, those lines are going to match. It's just a pretty way of showing your data here. So from a numbers standpoint, that the death before discharge, 31% versus 39%. So this was a pretty sick population with almost a third of the patients dying, even in the control groups or in the treatment group. And then 65% were breathing without assistance by day 28. And then the number of free ventilator days from 12 to 10, so which was much improved. Now this trial doesn't really fit in too much with less is more, but I think it's very important and it kind of correlates with the ARDSnet trial. It's a randomized controlled trial looking at minimal dissension versus increased recruitment, which is a kind of a different philosophy in ventilation. And they held true to the ARDSnet 6 mLs per kg of predicted body weight. And they had their goals of a SAT of a PaO2 of 55 to 80 and a SATs of 88 to 95. And pay attention that they kept their peak plateau pressures less than 30 as well. And they used a volume assist control mode. And then they some adjuncts to ventilation like prone positioning and nitric oxide were allowed. So they had a minimal distension group, and they essentially put these people in the ventilator and put their PEEPs from 5 to 9, and that's how they controlled their pressures. The increased recruitment group, they set plateau pressures at 28 to 30. And if you remember the ARDSnet paper, that's where kind of they wanted to keep their pressures below as well. The PEEP was titrated to the plateau pressure and had no effect on the oxygenation. So this is pretty busy, but we'll hone in on a couple of things here. The plateau pressures in the two groups, you've got minimal distension on the left and increased recruitment on the right. You can see that their plateau pressures were where they said they were going to be on the study. Well, the interesting thing to me is as you follow this along, as the days go along, you've got day 1, day 3, day 7. As you follow these along, the increased recruitment group, your plateau pressure got lower. So in my mind, the compliance is getting better on the patient's lungs that were that had these increased recruitment maneuvers. The FiO2 requirements, the oxygenation that they were requiring through the ventilator was going down in a stepwise fashion as well and much lower than the minimal distension group. And then the total PEEP that the patient received that between this also went down in a stepwise fashion in the increased recruitment group. So as time went on, the compliance got better. So how does that translate into anything that makes any sense? Well, we need to look. There was no difference in death in the first 28 days or death before discharge between the two groups. However, the number of ventilator-free days was significantly less, which translates into decreased risk for ventilator-associated pneumonia as well as decreased costs. These were sick patients. Ventilator-free days between 1 and 28. So they were off the ventilator for 3 days out of 28. That's a pretty sick group of patients versus 7 in the increased recruitment group. So they improved that by 4 days. So a lot of the talks this morning talk about residency is pretty taxing. You got to sleep when you can. So moving on to a different body system, the heart and the blood system, we're talking about decreased blood transfusion thresholds and decreased ratios of blood transfusions. I'm sorry, Dr. Barker. So this was kind of the main paper in 1999. It was a randomized controlled trial in the New England Journal of Medicine at 22 different centers. that were enrolled with a hemoglobin of less than 9 within 72 hours after admission. These patients were considered euvolemic. They were excluded if they weren't able to receive blood products, like our Jehovah's Witness. They were children. They were undergoing active blood loss. They had chronic anemia 1 month prior. They were pregnant, or they were suffered brain death, or imminent death was certain. They had a restrictive group, which was hemoglobins maintained from 7 to 9 and transfused at less than 7. The liberal group was maintained at a level of 10 to 12 and transfused for greater than 10. They were given one unit at a time. The hemoglobin was subsequently checked after that unit. They recommended the use of fluids and pressors when transfusion was not indicated, but most of those decisions were managed by the discretion of the provider that taking care of the patient. So on the left is the baseline characteristics of the patient. Again, very sick patients, Apache 2 score of 20 to 25, multiple organ dysfunctions, all equivalent throughout the problems. And if you look how it relates to us here, about 20% of the patients were trauma patients. So where did they come from before the ICU? You can see almost 40% came from the operating room, a smaller percentage from the emergency department. And the majority of them were sick and on the ventilator, something that we would never ever see in a study nowadays. 35% of the patients had pulmonary artery catheters, and some of them were on dialysis. The oxygen delivery variables between the patients were essentially the same prior to initiation of the trial. So looking at outcomes, the restricted transfusion strategy showed trends towards improvement in 30-day mortality, 60-day mortality, ICU mortality, and hospital mortality, with only statistically significant in the hospital mortality. in the number of organ failures, that if you look at the bottom there, the number of organs failing, a higher percentage of patients in the restricted category had less organs failing, but was not statistically significant. And looking at some subgroup analysis, the one on the chart on the left the graph on the left is the all patients, and in the middle and the right are two interesting subgroup analysis. One is the Apache 2 score less than 20, so patients that were less sick did better with a restrictive transfusion strategy, and patients on the right that were younger than 55 did better than a restrictive transfusion strategy. Now, is that because the patients that were sicker would do better with more blood, and older patients do better with more blood? I think I might side with Dr. Barker on this, and that's probably true based on this data. So they decreased the number of packed red cells that a patient got by 54%. They could not show that transfusion as a means to augment oxygen delivery, which we're all taught is the best way to augment oxygen delivery in physiology, did not show any advantage. And then there was no adverse effects with ischemic cardiomyopathy, with the concern that patients with ongoing heart disease have issues with being at a lower hemoglobin. So this was in 2000. 2016 will speed up to the Cochrane review, that since that trial, 31 trials, 13,000 patients were looked at during this Cochrane review. Half the studies used a hemoglobin of 7 and half used 8 to 9. And they essentially showed that there was a relative risk reduction that was statistically significant of people receiving transfusions, which is what you would expect in a study looking at restricting blood transfusions. They did not show any difference in 30-day mortality, myocardial infarction, CHF, cerebral vascular accident, rebleeding, or pneumonia within these statistically significant, but you can see some trends. Decreased CHF, decreased CVA, decreased rebleeding in those patients. So they showed a relative risk reduction of 43% receiving transfusions. They also showed that there was no difference in the studies that used 7 versus 8 or 9. And they found that in acute blood loss or trauma, the risk of rebleeding was half in a restrictive transfusion setting. So that kind of goes along with one of the things we're going to talk about next. This is, we talked about this morning, that things come out of war, and this is one of the papers that came out of the Iraq and Afghanistan conflict, is hemostatic resuscitation during surgery and time of hemorrhage, that it improves survival. So this was a 7-year retrospective trial, 435 emergency surgeries that required 10 units of transfusion, at least 10 units of blood. And of those, 135 of the patients had a trauma-induced coagulopathy. So almost 40% of the patients died. They look specifically at the ratios. Now, I'll preface this. When you read the literature, the transfusion, the 1-to-1, 1-to-4, is packed red blood cells to plasma. And it would say high, and if you read it now, it'll say higher ratios improve survival. But for this talk, we're going to say lower because it fits in with the themes, the theme of the talk. So the lower of the ratio, being 1-to-1-to-1, is a low ratio on the, for this talk. That the mortality was improved, you can see pretty significantly, almost cut in half when you used a more balanced resuscitation of packed red blood cells to fresh frozen plasma. There's numerous other studies that prompt the proper trial that I could go into and talk for the entire time about for this. But it doesn't come down until you're in the operating room and you see 1-to-1-to-1 resuscitation work. So the case with Dr. Barker and I, and this patient received 1-to-1-to-1 resuscitation, less than 2,000 crystalloid, had a cardiac repair, and was extubated 2 days later. That same night was date night at the hospital with my wife. This was, I think, Heather's last flight, and we had just finished that case with Dr. Barker, and she brought in another patient. So we'll start getting into more controversial stuff now. We'll talk about GI nutrition and TPN. So this was in the New England Journal of Medicine in 2011. This is a large study, randomized controlled trial of almost 5,000 patients. And they underwent the early, which was a kind of the traditional European thought process on TPN and nutrition, versus late. It was what some of the American societies were prescribing to in the ICU. And early enteral nutrition, feeding through the gut, was initiated in both groups and kind of paralleled, had a standardized way they did that. There were multiple exclusion criteria. And essentially, they were included with the NRS scale of greater than 3. So this is kind of what that looks like, what an NRS scale looks like. And you can see the majority of the patients that we take care of that are critically ill in the ICU fall in this greater than 3 category, at least a moderate, a 2 here. And then you can imagine that 25 to 60% of the calories that they don't get for the prior week. So the majority of the patients that we see are at least a 2. And you get it, if you're over 70, you get an additional point. So the baseline characteristics of both study groups is essentially equivocal. This is pretty interesting. I thought this graph, these graphs were very enlightening as what they did. On the left, you have enteral nutrition, and in the middle, you have the TPN, the parenteral nutrition. And this is total energy and total total energy and essentially calories that they were getting. And from a parenteral nutrition, the late initiation was down here. So they started off not getting, but initially, but by about day 8, by late initiation, they were at full calories, and which is very nicely depicted on both of these. So what'd they find? Well, they found that discharge alive from the ICU within 8 days, you had 75% on the late initiation group and 71%. So a little bit, it was statistically significant, but a small percentage of patients. So it was a large sample size. The other thing that they found is the duration of stay in the ICU. From the late initiation group had one less day, but for the patients, the number of patients that were there greater than 3 days, they had 3% less, which can, if you're looking at TPN and the cost, that could be a significant amount. When looking at an infection, one of the things we always worry about with TPN is infections, and any new infection was significantly reduced in the late initiation group from 22 to 26%. And then duration of mechanical ventilation was statistically significant, which is something that we always talk about as the caloric need and being on the respiratory quotient on the ventilator. So anywhere from 36% to 40%. They did have significantly more episodes of hypoglycemia during intervention, the late initiation group did. And they were all on D5 solutions, but they had statistically significant more evidence of hypoglycemia. When you looked at the acute kidney injury specifically, which I thought was interesting, is the late initiation group had statistically significant less number of incidents of kidney failure, and then the duration of hospitalization was 2 days longer, 2 days shorter. So in a subgroup analysis, looking at patients specifically that we would be interested in is the patients that early enteral nutrition is contraindicated. So your post-op surgery patient that had multiple bowel resections or had intra-abdominal catastrophe that you're really concerned about starting early enteral nutrition, those patients had a greater benefit from late initiation than any other patient. Now, was that because that the more TPN, they received more TPN and had more opportunities for acquiring an infection or some of the poor consequences of TPN? It's not determined from that study, but potentially. So one of the things postulated is that withholding these macronutrients may enhance recovery, and that's because it's, you're suppressing the autophagy, and that's essentially inadequate clearance of cell damage in microorganisms. So if you're suppressing that, then you're doing better. This is Heather and I. This is my one plug. This is Heather and I at the Heroes Run. Make sure everybody registers. It's coming up July 16th, I believe, put on by the Trauma Center here. So we'll go into something that I really find interesting and talk about is kidneys and acute kidney injury. And we'll talk about decreasing CRRT dose and decreased time to CRRT initiation. In 2009, in the New England Journal of Medicine, this is a randomized controlled trial of 1,500 patients that they needed renal replacement therapy. And this was deemed by urine output less than 100 for 6 hours, hyperkalemia, acidemia, azotemia, or organ edema, as in pulmonary edema or volume overload of some sort. Both treatments groups were treated with CVV-HDF, and just a review of what that is essentially dialysate, where you have blood from the patient going to a blood pump, and you're giving either replacement through it. It's essentially three modalities with convection, dialysis, and hemofiltration as far as how the blood is filtered through the body. As the where all modalities can be used or taken away. And they underwent post-filter replacement fluid, and their dialysate to replacement fluid was at a 1-to-1 ratio, which kept things standardized. And all blood flow rates were set at 150. And the fluid removal was performed by decreasing the fluid removal and the dialysate equally. That way they could keep everything continuous. And they were randomized to either a dose of 40 mls per kg an hour or 25 mls per kg an hour based on the machine dose, not based on a dose calculated by their clearance of solute. Their mean age was 65, 75% of them were on the ventilator, 50% of them were septic shock, and a quarter of them were surgical patients. And oliguria was the most common reason for initiation of therapy. So they found that there was no difference in death, no difference in place of death, no difference in renal replacement dependence or long-term dialysis, and no difference in organ failure between either group. The only difference they were able to show was that the number of episodes of hypophosphatemia was higher in the higher intensity group. They were removing more phosphorus from the patient and having to replace that substantially, 65% versus 54%. And then all other electrolytes and arrhythmias and disequilibrium there was no different. So they concluded that the lower dose decreased costs, decreased hypophosphatemia, because there's significant cost with running the dialysate at higher volumes. Almost double the volume is double the amount of fluids that you have to use, which is double the cost. And then the patients at the higher dose, there's thought to be some, there are some smaller papers out there that talk about that this higher dose can lead to protein malnutrition and dialyze off the nutrients and vitamins and micronutrients, as well as it's very difficult to control antimicrobial drug levels at higher doses as well. So we've initiated CRRT, or we talk about initiating CRRT. When do we really need to start it? Traditionally, renal replacement therapy is started with oliguria that's sustained for over 72 hours, elevated BUN, hyperkalemia, acidemia, pH less than 7.15, or volume overload. This study in JAMA looked at early versus delayed, a randomized clinical trial of 231 critically ill patients that did early initiation within 8 hours of diagnosis of stage 2 kidney disease. So what stage 2 is this is the more updated diagnosis of acute kidney injury, is stage 1 through 3, and stage 2 is essentially two times the baseline. So anyone that comes in with and their BUN goes to 2.2 and they're not making a half a cc per kg for 12 hours. So pretty aggressive early initiation here in this population versus starting it in stage 3. So late initiation was in 12 hours of diagnosis of stage 3. So again, there you can compare those two. So what did they look at? The primary outcome was 90-day all-cause mortality. And the early group had 44 versus 65%, or 40% versus 54% in 90 days all-cause mortality. It was a pretty significant reduction in mortality. There's no statistical difference in the 28-day mortality. They did show a difference between the requirements of renal replacement long-term. So these patients were initiated on and had to be continued on renal replacement therapy at 28 days. And then the duration of renal replacement therapy, this was one of the things that was most surprising to me when I looked at this study, was the duration in the early initiation was substantially shorter than the late initiation group. And here's just a kind of picture of what all that numbers look like in much prettier format, that the earlier is better on overall mortality. And then as far as breaking down and looking at other variables, there was no difference between the two, except for respiratory and coagulopathy issues. They showed improvement, statistical improvement in respiratory and coagulation issues from the patients that were receiving early initiation. And the main thing, I guess, that most people would want to know, well, did these people recover renal function? And there's substantially more patients recovered renal function, 53% versus 40% at 90 days post-injury. This was my last day in the ICU getting around with Lillian. She's little there. She's not so little anymore. And Heather was really concerned at that time about infections, so we'll talk about infections and giving Lillian some terrible infection being up there. So we'll talk about de-escalation of antibiotics and decreased post-operative antibiotic days. So this was in the a medicine journal about prospective observational study of 600 patients that were admitted to the ICU with sepsis or septic shock. And they de-escalated antibiotics, and this was defined as either discontinuing one agent and or changing an antibiotic to a more narrow spectrum as the culture results were available. They were, I don't know if this has something to do with a comment on, because this was a medicine journal, on surgeons or how surgeons are, but de-escalation therapy was more commonly performed in medical than surgical patients. The severity of illness in the first 24 hours of ICU admission didn't influence the antimicrobial therapy modification. And this was interesting. The SOFA score, how severely injured the patient was on the day of the culture results, was higher in those patients whose therapy was escalated compared to the other groups. Which kind of makes sense. If the patient doesn't look good on the day that you get culture data, you may not de-escalate because in your mind it might not be what looks like right for the patient. So this graph shows the ICU mortality, hospital mortality, and mortality at 90 days. And the light colored is the de-escalation group, the middle gray is no change, and the other group is gray is the escalation. And I think you could probably say to not look at these patients, because those patients, something happened on the day that you were supposed to de-escalate, because the SOFA score was statistically different. But you can see the mortality was much lower in the patients that had a de-escalation of antibiotics to the appropriate antibiotic. And that was across the board from ICU, hospital, and mortality at 90 days. So looking at the mortality at 90 days, septic shock was probably the one of the major odds ratio that led to mortality at 90 days. And then they also showed that when they controlled for everything else, that inadequate empiric antibiotic antimicrobial therapy was also right there along with septic shock. The SOFA score was marginally significant on 11% for the day the culture results were back. And then they showed that de-escalation of therapy was a protective factor, a reduction of almost 45%. So that leads us into what pertains more to what we do. This is the STOP-IT trial in New England Journal of Medicine 2015, that 500 patients and 23 centers that were randomly assigned for antibiotics for 2 days after resolution of fever, white blood cell count, or an ileus for a maximum of 2 days. These were patients that had some sort of intra-abdominal sepsis going on, versus just antibiotics for 4 days. And the composite endpoint that combined everything: surgical site infection, recurrent intra-abdominal infection, or death within 30 days into their analysis. If you look at the organ of origin, it was usually the colon or rectum, followed by the appendix or small bowel. And the source control procedures on the right, being percutaneous drainage being the highest source control procedure, but you can see resection and anastomosis has happened in about 25% of those patients. So the time, they showed no statistical difference between the primary outcome, which was surgical site infection, recurrent intra-abdominal infection, or death between the two groups. But the one thing they did show is that the time to identify the second event, you know, so all these patients got infections. In the control group, 15 days later, the second intra-abdominal infection that wasn't treated adequately was diagnosed, versus 8 days shorter, or, you know, 6 days shorter in the experimental group. And there was no difference in death. So essentially, the quicker you start the antibiotics, the quicker you'll find out that you've got to retreat your next infection and diagnose that, because it's not going to cover it anyways. It's essentially the meat and potatoes of that. So there was no, they also showed that there was no difference in nosocomial infections, including C. diff, which I was very surprised. And the infectious complications were more than 20% in both patient populations. Most were recurrent intra-abdominal infections, which you would always think to be the case. And then neither shortening nor lengthening the duration helped the infectious outcome. The only thing that helped was decreasing the time to identifying the next infection. Because they didn't show any difference in C. diff, I wanted to put this paper in here and talk about C. difficile for a minute. And this was a single center retrospective review of 2 years looking at their essentially elective surgery procedures between 72 hours and 12 weeks after admission from the surgery. And then they had over 11,000 surgeries that they looked at and over four hospital units. And they found that on the different units, that the number of cases for C. diff, the percentage was the highest in trauma surgery, because the number of admissions versus the number of cases was, the ratio was so much higher, and the rate was higher in trauma and general surgery compared to orthopedic and neurosurgery. One of the biggest risk factors was admission in the past year. So had that patient been in the hospital previously, they were at a higher likelihood of getting C. diff. And then they found the risk factors, like I said, the number of risk factors, the older, sicker patients, the ASA 4 and 5 were significantly higher. So the older, sicker, readmitted multiple time patient is the highest risk for C. diff. Any patient that had antibiotic use was in the previous 6 months. They did show that you being on a PPI or H2 blocker in the previous 6 months increased your the odds ratio of getting C. diff. And then having antibiotics continued for more than 24 hours. So the 65-year-old with diabetes, heart disease, and been in the hospital 3 times in the last year for diverticulitis, comes in with a perforated diverticulitis and gets an operation and gets antibiotics continued for more than 24 hours, is really high risk for getting Clostridium difficile. This is a this was not Clostridium difficile, but this is what a toxic metacolon might look like, and this is one of the fun colons that we got to take out. So talking about fluids, we're talking about decreasing IV fluids, and this is one of the main papers. This was 1994. Of immediate versus delayed fluid resuscitation in a hypotensive patient with a penetrating torso trauma. This was looked at not giving as much volume to a patient prior to getting control of the hemorrhage. And if you see the two differences, the volume here versus here, these guys were ahead of their time in 1994. It's taken a long time to get here, and I think we're finally there as far as our facility is concerned. They showed the postoperative complications that patients with immediate resuscitation and had high volume resuscitation had a lot more incidence of ARDS, but not really anything else. They showed that there was more than one complication in patients that got more fluids and was statistically significant. The biggest variable that they showed was the survival to discharge. This is a really sick patient population, you can imagine, penetrating torso trauma, that the survival to discharge was 62 versus 70% of patients, so statistically significant reduction in the survival to discharge with using a lower volume. So we take a lot of these papers and put them together in this meta-analysis, and this, if you look here, this is just kind of a nice pictorial of papers that favor fluid restriction versus liberal fluid restriction, and you can see all across the board and overall that the favor of fluid restriction. And this is another meta-analysis, and the variables are switched and backwards. So this is limited fluid resuscitation, and this is essentially regular fluid resuscitation. And the majority of the papers, some more than others, show a reduction in the risk ratio of, and this is mortality here, in patients that are with hemorrhagic shock. And then they looked specifically at certain variables, specifically the coagulopathy, you know, the PT and PTT, and you can see that a limited fluid resuscitation decreases that coagulopathy by not having a dilutional coagulopathy from the amount of saline that we're giving. And that carries over on to multi-organ dysfunction, as we talked about in the paper in 1994, as well as incidence of ARDS is much less in a limited fluid resuscitation strategy. So what happens when you give too much fluid is you get compartment syndrome. This is a video of what a third spacing of a lot of volume looks like here. Oh, it's not that much, but then here we go. The patient that had pancreatitis that received liters upon liters of fluid resuscitation and developed compartment syndrome. It's still going. And in a second here, you can hear the suction canister, the Neptune, stop up because it reached capacity, which is over 4 liters. Goes. It's filling up. So most recently, this year, from our colleagues up the street in Nashville, this is a New England Journal of Medicine study in 2018, was a randomized control trial in 5 of their ICUs looking at 16,000 patients. They were either randomized to saline or balanced crystalloid solution, either plasmolite A or Ringer's lactate, and the primary outcome was major adverse kidney event within 30 days. And that was a composite from any cause, death from any cause, renal replacement therapy, or persistent renal dysfunction. And they showed that there was a major adverse kidney event, 14% versus 15% when you compared lactated Ringer's or plasmolite A to saline alone. They showed that there was a reduction in hospital death. And when they looked at subgroup analysis, there was a greater difference among patients who received the larger volumes of isotonic crystalloid. So like the patient in the video that received the large volumes of crystalloid, if he would receive normal saline, that he had a higher likelihood of doing worse than the patients that don't receive a large volume. And then patients with sepsis, the 30-day in-hospital mortality was 25% versus 29% when they adjusted that. So why does this happen? It's thought to be, you know, due to a high chloride content leads to hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis and inflammation, causing renal vasoconstriction, acute kidney injury, and eventually hypotensive and death. There's been studies that involve healthy volunteers that suggest saline may decrease renal perfusion through chloride-mediated renal vasoconstriction. This specific study here looked at just hyperchloremia as the single variable and looked at mortality and odds ratio of mortality based on hyperchloremia admission and in the hospital. And they showed that higher levels of chloride were worsening, and worsening hyperchloremia were associated with an all-cause hospital mortality, independent of any other risk factors. So in conclusion, don't assault your patients. There's things that we could talk about for the next rest of the day and weekend of things that are we have doing less with, less hemodynamic monitoring, less glycemic control, less steroids, less daily chest x-rays, less oxygen, less inhaled nitrous oxide, less oscillators, and not using some of the things that we've traditionally used. But with that, I would like to say thanks, and nobody can say thanks better than a trauma patient.
Taking care of me, I do appreciate it.
I'll take any questions or comments.
A brief question or comment from anybody about this excellent, comprehensive talk. Well, thank you, Chris. That's quite a survey, and we appreciate that very much. You're going to set us up for... All right, our last talk of the day is Nick Belay. Nick came to us from Louisiana, from the LSU Shreveport Medical School, and I think at one point planned that he might be a critical care doctor. Like Chris, but after he did his rotation up in Athens with the guys up there, Tom Lehman and others, decided that that's what he wanted to do, and was so enthusiastic about it that he's been recruited to join them there, and will be doing so. One of the things that we're happy in his case is he's one of the graduates that's going to immediately become a faculty member. And Dr. Giles and I are looking forward to continuing him to work on his projects here, including the skills lab, as I mentioned earlier, working with Richard Cook and others too in that program. So we're really proud that he's staying and proud that he's going to be with us, and look forward to having him continue as a faculty member here in addition to a great practitioner in an area of where would be considered rural most places. Nick. And while he comes up here and gets started, I just want to make one brief point. I meant to do it before. First of all, I haven't recognized individual faculty because we have so many here today, and thank you very much for being here. But the other thing is, I think all of our incoming interns are here, and they're sitting in a row right there, or two rows, and would all of you raise your hand, because we're so proud to have you, we won't embarrass you and make you stand. We're especially proud to have you, and I think you get some sense of where we think you'll be 6 years from now. Nick.
Thank you, Dr. Burns.
Hey!
So like a soft whistle in the night, Dr. Richardson gave his presidential address in 2002, and he warned of a general surgery workforce shortage. He noted at that time, without any statistical validation, his concerns and observations as requests piled up on his desks for other people out in rural communities looking for partners, headhunters in small community hospitals asking, "We need help. Do you know anybody?" He also was very concerned because, like a warning shot across the bow of a ship in 2001, very highly regarded surgery residencies, it was one of the first years where they didn't match a lot of their categorical positions. He also noted in his talk a growing disconnect between specialist and broad-based general surgery practitioners who maybe didn't want to take emergency general surgery call at night anymore, or possibly take the patient who didn't have insurance who needed an elective operation. And he spoke about these things. And in 2012, Dr. Kofer wrote a monograph calling out to these upcoming issues of the workforce shortage, about the training for rural surgeons, the scope of practice they would need, how to recruit them and retain them there, and how to have a maintenance of the quality for good surgery in rural areas. Now here we are, 2018, and in 2017, the United States government has finally heard the cries for attention, and so passed the Ensuring Access to General Surgery Act of 2017. And this would allow the Secretary of the Human and Health Services to issue a formal general surgery shortage area designation. And this could, with government funds, incentivize surgeons to come and stay in rural areas and work there. So the question I ask is, who's going to fill their shoes? So since 1981 to 2005, the number of general surgeons per 100,000 has actually been declining, and has declined by a rate of 25.9%. In 1981, 7.68 general surgeons per 100,000 were noted. And in 2005, it was down to 5.69 per 100,000. And this is the result of population growth, up by 29% in that time, and a decrease in the absolute number of general surgeons by 4.2%. When you look at this map, what you see is a lot of white. 72% of the nation's landmass is rural America, and 60 million Americans live in that landmass. Right now, in 2011 data, they noted about 6 per 100,000 general surgeons. But there's an issue of maldistribution. There's 1,144 counties without any general surgeon at this time. If you look at the change, from 2006 to 2011, the color you note now is brown all throughout America. And that's because 1,139 counties lost their general surgeon in that time period. If you see dark brown, those are the 206 counties that lost all their general surgeons. So as we look into the future, as I hope my son is doing here, do we see new surgeons ready to step in and fill the void? Unfortunately, no, is my answer. The Balanced Budget Act of 1997 has capped the GME budget, only allowing 1,000 to 1,030 graduates per year. Furthermore, there has been a trend, and 80% of graduates annually choose fellowship. And lastly, Marriott Hawkins in 2017 did a survey of medical students, and only 3% said that they would be willing to go practice in a community of less than 25,000. Just recently, in March of this year, the AAMC put out their projections report. What's the most telling and shocking thing I found is that under surgical subspecialties, it will actually be in the negative by 2030. And that's because the number of newly trained surgeons is going to be outweighed by the attrition and the retirement of our surgeons. There's also which I find very despairing, the millennials are projected to work 5 to 13% fewer hours than their 2000-2002 cohorts. Meanwhile, a physician supply only increases by 7%. The population will be growing by 11%. You have a 3% decline in the physician-to-patient ratio. One of the big issues, as you can see, the bottom lines, is this supply in hours, as the millennials want to work less. Also, the surge is wanting to retire earlier. Right now, greater than 65 years of age, 13.5% of the active workforce. That's what you're looking at. 55 to 64 years old, that's 27.2% of the workforce. And with the way the economy goes, who knows when they want to just retire early. And so I'm left very perplexed, because let's all ask ourselves one question. Who wouldn't want to be me? Look at these people. They are having so much fun with me. Unfortunately, as one mentor once said to me, previous generations lived to work. Current generations work to live. There's a study by Sanfrey, 70% of medical students believe surgeons do not lead well-balanced lives, and medical students want to shun the rigors of surgical training. They view the training as malignant and the profession to be too demanding with an uncontrollable lifestyle. This was a survey that somewhat blew my mind. In 2009, they did a survey of 248 of 249 U.S. residency training programs. There was an 82.4 response. 38.6 strongly agreed that the field of general surgery will become obsolete. The majority, as you continue to look on down, felt that you had to become a specialty to be successful, that all your surgeries were going to be taken over by specialties, that you're going to have a better lifestyle if you're a specialty, and that you can't compete in the job market if you're not a specialty. There was another cross-sectional national survey that was done in 2008, and one of the telling things that I found hidden in that report was that 27.5% expressed concern because they would not feel confident performing procedures independently. And this was a reason why they chose specialization and a fellowship. I just feel, as I looked through the literature, that nothing could be further from the truth. I'll count this as literature.
So, Doc, what do you think of our town?
Well, I don't know. I haven't seen all of it yet.
Oh, yeah, you have. Opportunity abounds here.
The growth rate was up 0.3% last year.
There's no crime. By the way, we are the county seat.
Fellas, no point beating the dead horse. Death, that's all in the brochure.
Benstone, we are prepared to offer you a permanent position as medical practitioner supreme here in the greater Grady metropolitan area and squash capital of the South. The salary is $27,000 per annum and plus cuts.
$27,000?
You see, Nick, I told you.
Hold on, hold on. $30,000.
Look, you people don't even know me.
Oh, I know this right off, Betty. Double knots of shoelaces.
No excellent credentials.
Show she's careful.
Anyway, don't you already have a doctor?
So we got to start looking towards recruitment. So 57% of general surgery indicated that a mentor significantly influenced them to choose that field. Students who rotated with non-metropolitan centers one-on-one, like Dr. Lehman gives his time to do with the DO students, drastically increases their surgical interest. 82% of medical students that go on to do a JI in surgery will also go on to pursue surgery. This was a really funny fact. What is the worst job in the operating room? Driving the laparoscopic camera. But yet 7.2 times more likely will a medical student be interested in doing surgery if they ever get that job? So, looked at resident preparation for careers in general surgery, they surveyed the program directors. It was a growing trend, actually, where the ACS rotation became the main way to teach general surgery, going from 63% to 83%. Institutions will also note fewer fellowships and fewer surgical specialties graduated more people who pursued general surgery. The addition of each fellowship at an institution was associated with a 2% decrease in the number of graduates pursuing general surgery. Another study showed when they looked at factors that influenced your decision to pursue general surgery versus a fellowship, again, 57% of those who chose general surgery indicated they had a mentor, somebody who influenced their decision. They also noted in the study that those who had greater confidence in their surgical abilities at the chief year had a higher rate of going into general surgery as opposed to those who went into fellowship. Here's a study from Oregon Health and Sciences University, and they partnered with surgeons at Three Rivers Community Hospital. It's a population of about 23,000. And they did a deliberate planning of a rural track, and they wanted to make sure that these people enjoyed the small town, living and also giving them autonomy to impart confidence in them. This allowed them to expand their knowledge and skills. What's interesting is I see some of these residents end up being like me, who I originally wanted to do trauma critical care. 50 at the beginning said they wanted to they were going to specialize. So they put 5 in this rural track. 4 ended up changing their mind going on to practice general surgery, and only 1 continued with his original plan. When I was looking to join Dr. Lehman and Dr. Samita and planning for my transition to practice fellowship, I would look at other programs and what they had done. The American College of Surgeons only lists 12 programs that actually have, and we are one of them. Also, we're also noted in a lot of different studies for our program. I thought that was quite complimentary. But in this study, what they found was there was 44 programs. If you look through the ACS, the FRIDA, and then also by a survey that they sent out, that were willing to either already had a track or would customize a track. There were 7 programs in particular that said that would never be a mission of their program. I thought that was telling. How about you won't be able to get a job? This is just a still shot in time of positions in Wisconsin and Oregon that they looked at. And in fact, the fellowship required, there was only 24 positions available. But fellowship not required, there were 47. And then if you got a little bit extra training, such as you could show that during your general surgery time, you went and scrubbed with OB, and you learned how to do hysterectomies and oophorectomies. If you scrubbed and did extra endocrine cases, if you had gotten advanced endoscopy or laparoscopy skills, that's all they were looking for. They're not looking for a fellowship. They just want to look at your case logs. So as we go through and you start becoming a chief, right now you're in residency and you got the scut work to do and you're making your salary and you're getting by. And you start thinking about what is your value? What will your value be when you get out once you have this education? So start with some monetary value, which I found very impressive, was that you, if all you did was employ in your office one registered nurse, a medical assistant, and a bookkeeper, and you gave them 20 benefits, this is how much it would cost you, and your office would still turn out this revenue. Now say you're actually operating, and you're doing inpatient procedures and outpatient procedures. And this was an average of rural surgeons that they looked at that time. Their total revenue is $1.34 million. This also, which was really surprising to me, it makes me feel proud going into a small town, you could say that when they look at those numbers, the monetary value, you are responsible for employing 15 people, just having your set of knowledge. Furthermore, I don't understand economics, but there's something called multipliers. Output multiplier, income multiplier, and employment multiplier. This has to do with affecting your town's economy. And when you do that, it ends up being, when they added up, about $2.4 million that you put into the economy of the town you join. Also, what's even more impressive to me is that you gave 25.9 families a job. So what is your value to the hospital? That's your value to the economy and to your office staff. Well, it's great, because in small rural areas, right now, there usually is only one general surgeon. In large, there's about three, is the median. Unfortunately, because of issues with retention of surgeons in rural areas, in the next 2 years, you get 27% of small rural areas, they're losing that one surgeon. 48% are losing one surgeon from here. How long does it take to get another one? It takes about a year. Can your hospital survive for that year? And they polled the hospital administrators, and it was really impressive to hear that these that 12% of the hospitals said they would actually have to close their doors if they lost their general surgeon, because the revenue they depend on. So where do we stand? And I challenge you to find this place. You think discovery rounds with Dr. Moore cool? Kyle Cunningham was one of my chiefs, and we did discovery rounds. There was an in-ground pool in our lair at one point in time, I found, and there was a spiral staircase. The pool's gone, sorry guys. The spiral staircase is out there. So, looked at the general surgeon workforce in Tennessee in the era of the Affordable Care Act. So let's bring it on home, see where do we stand. There are 95 counties in the state, and 43 were considered shorted, meaning they didn't have enough general surgeons to fill three per 100,000. That was their cutoff. If you had over the amount, that's over six per 100,000. So they looked, and this was in 2013, I believe, and a total of 531 active general surgeons were found. This gives us an 8.4 per 100,000. So our state's doing pretty good. The issue is it's a maldistribution. There were still a number of communities that were short, and 23 of these surgeons would need to be required to move from one of the urban areas in order to meet that 3 per 100,000. Again, with the 2017 bill that was passed, maybe incentives can be brought up to help move those surgeons and provide that access to care. This is a great paper that was produced by our institution, by our program director, and Dr. Lehman, and Dr. Smita, and Dr. Brown, and Dr. Burns, and Dr. Kofer. And this was a survey to all our residents, and our residents are pretty happy with the Athens rotation. What's most important, as you can see, the fives, is because of the endoscopy experience that's already been alluded to. Per statistics, our endoscopy experience is greater than 90th percentile in the nation. That's how well you get trained here. Also, one of the more telling things is over here is people's opinion of the rotation when they first started was 3.1, but at the end, they actually were considering a rural general surgery career. It moved up to 3.5. Two people switched over to strongly agree. I would fall into that category. So looking at the hospitals here in Tennessee and surveying the rural Tennessee hospital administrators, the town size, you're looking at about, in small rural areas, 5,000. In the large rural, which Athens, McMinn County counts as a large rural because it's 13,000 people. The median is about 15,000. But your service area of who you will take care of is much higher. There's a lot of work out there. Just ask Dr. Lehman. So how do we compare it with national data? Well, our number of surgeons older than 50, right on par. Our percentage of surgeons that are leaving in the next 2 years, we're retaining a little better. And recruiting, our hospitals are actively recruiting more. Again, population, our town sizes are a little bigger than what the national data showed. and our service areas are a little bigger because Tennessee's a great place to live. What was an incidental finding and very impressive in this study was this multiple regression analysis. And what it showed was that when a hospital had more gross revenue than expected based on bed count, it usually had more surgeons and vice versa. That's what this shows. So you have gross revenue and it's below the trend, but also your number of full-time surgeons was below the trend. Flip side, if your gross revenue was higher, then your number of surgeons was higher. They kept bed count the same. Now, I showed value in a monetary form, value to the hospital. But who are you really trying to give value to? And it's the patients. And we've got true red, white, and blue American patients. So much so, and Dr. Lehman can attest to this, the disease process that you get to see when you go rotate up there. Patients prefer to stay local. So much so, there was one study done, and they took 100 vets, and they said, if you can go to this regional specialized care center, your risk of mortality is 3%. You can stay home, your risk of mortality is 3% with a Whipple. They said, I'm going to stay home. I'm not going to go to that special center. They said, fine. What if I told you your risk was 6%? Your mortality risk was 6%. 45 out of 100 still said, I'm staying home, and I'm getting it done at my hospital. They said, fine. What if it was 12%? 23 said, I'm staying home, and I'm going to my hospital. And then lastly, they said, what if it was 18%? Six times the normal mortality rate. And 18 out of 100 still said, I'm not going anywhere. They challenged that at one point in time in the study, did these people understand what mortality risk was? And further confirmed that they did understand what that meant. Because the investigators couldn't believe that somebody would accept such a high risk. Another study was the relationship between travel distance and utilization of breast cancer treatment in rural northern Michigan. And this was looking at between breast conservation therapy and a modified radical mastectomy. And only 24.2% of the rural sample chose to get the breast conservation therapy. This is half the national average. And it has to do with travel. They would rather just stay home and not have to travel all the way to another town or another city to get the radiation therapy. They'd rather just get the modified radical mastectomy, which is quite telling. And then lastly, in orthopedics, they offered the patients two things. They said either you can have a 2% mortality risk and we can get your joint replacement in a month here at home, or you can have a 1% mortality risk and we'll do you in 6 months at a specialized center. 43% chose the 2% mortality risk. So how about your value to the system? There are disparities in access to emergency general surgery care in the United States. Every little red dot is an emergency general surgery area. This means that it has a 24/7 ER, it's got 24/7 anesthesia, and a 24/7 surgeon that can operate. They went and specifically looked at Maine. And according to the 2010 census, 60% of Maine's population is rural. And they also, at that time, had the oldest population, greater than 65 years of age. This little circle represents a 60-mile radius from the tertiary care center. The furthest transfer, each of these red dots is a patient that was transferred, and that's their zip code area. It was up to 300 miles away were transferred. This can be a big burden on the system if that's how you're transferring patients. We've seen that. Long ER waits, people in the hallway. But you want to take care of them, and you want them to come to you. But what if you had a surgeon in that rural area that could take care of them? And there's things I'm going to have to learn going forward is how to juggle this, as I've talked to my attendings. Because the problem is, in a rural area, this is transferred patients, and these are local patients. The transferred patients were usually older. They were poorer with Medicare. And they had a higher rate of ICU admission because they're sicker. But what was most impressive in the study to me was that 31% needed no surgical intervention at all. It was just that they needed a surgeon to be available, such as if they had perforated diverticulitis, maybe it's Henschy 1 or Henschy 2, and they just need antibiotics and to be observed. Or it could have been, there was one, it was a DVT. It was these kind of things that didn't need an operation. Oh, small bowel obstruction was the number two, where just an NG tube and just wait and watch them. Furthermore, of those that got an intervention, it was things such as appendectomies, incarcerated inguinal or umbilical hernias, or cholecystectomies. These are basic procedures that every trained general surgeon can do in their institution if they have the OR staff, and should be able to do in their rural community and not bog down a tertiary care center. Now, I'm talking about rural surgeons. Sometimes we sit there as I'm talking, you might start daydreaming about what a rural surgeon is like.
Doctor!
I'm just in the middle of surgery.
I can come back.
You're not big on the hand washing, are you?
We may have to take that off. Otherwise, you might wind up with a case of toe foot.
I don't think that's a real thing.
A million ways to die in the West.
I'm sorry, I couldn't save her, Albert.
She had a splinter.
Doc, what the hell were you supposed to do?
Can we get in on this grave?
Yeah, sure. Doctor!
So lately, there's been a push for the pledge, the volume pledge, and the regionalization. And studies come out saying you have an increased risk of mortality if you're not at this specialized center or that specialized center. But there are basic surgical cases that we do that can be handled at rural hospitals. So looking at the scope of practice at general surgeons across America, the mean number of different procedures, 28, 35, 16, 23, these surgeons can operate. And when you look at the majority of operations that they may do in their practice, things come up that you think they would be able to do. Cholecystectomies, colonoscopies, upper GI endoscopies, skin excisions. I found this interesting, that 22 surgeons, the vast majority of their practice was hemodialysis access, colorectal resection. But if we look at the rural surgeons, it almost plays out the exact same way when you look at the percentage of their practice. When I talked earlier about the job market and being a general surgeon plus having some extra training, 12% of rural surgeons practice, 12% of their practice is specialty procedures. And I'm just so happy that I train here, because when I saw the list, I said to myself, those are everyday operations. Those aren't specialty procedures. But they're listed under specialty things, like cardiothoracic and neurosurgery. That would be a carpal tunnel release, by the way. Obstetrics and gynecology, orthopedics, otolaryngology, urology, vascular. Specifically for vascular, put in a central line, put in a port. Obstetrics and gynecology, cesarean sections, hysterectomies, tubal ligations. Orthopedics, do an amputation. Just hang out with Dr. Fisher. Ganglion cyst excisions, you'll do those in Athens. Cardiothoracic, chest tubes, bronchoscopy, pacemaker insertion. Urology, vasectomies. You can learn how to do those in office with Dr. Lehman. Circumcisions, you see those on pediatrics. Otolaryngology, I did my transition to practice fellowship, and thankfully I had good mentors who helped me out with tonsils and adenoids, tympanostomy tube placement, and control of nasal hemorrhage. If you looked at the 20 procedures with the largest volume in the general surgery cohort, again, across America, they're pretty much the same procedures. Colonoscopy, cholecystectomy, upper gastrointestinal endoscopy, hernias, skin excisions. Now, these patients aren't going to die from a splinter. In fact, when they looked at the variability in general surgical procedures in rural versus urban, the resource demand was actually lower for the rural surgeon. The length of stay for the patient was lower, and the mortality was lower. This was further confirmed when they looked at emergency general surgery patients. Now, I'm no statistician, But if you have to go through three different types of mathematical formulas, whenever originally your raw data does show mortality is 1.7 rural, 1.53 urban, but then your complication rate was lower, cost of care is lower, your length of stay is lower in rural. And then after two different calculations, both those different calculations shown there was basically no absolute difference between rural and urban. And the reason for that has to do with the general surgeons that are out there in that community and knowing what they can handle. There's this this thought that, and I'm going to be outside hospital soon. I just realized that the other day. Y'all are going to get a transfer and say, oh, it came from outside hospital. Call it ballet outside hospital. Okay? It's that you have to know the limits of your facility. And we're not cherry picking so we can go play golf. There's actually a lot of volume at the end. These patients need access to care and they need care. But because when you're there, I feel like going forward, I could do a lot of operations. But probably I shouldn't because can my hospital handle it? One of the biggest things I've learned is that when it comes to patients' morbidity, it has to do with what's called a rescue, is identifying that a patient has a problem as soon as possible and getting the help they need. Maybe it's IR. Maybe it's another subspecialty. Because when you're out in the community, surgical critical care isn't an elevator right away. It's a helicopter right away. And lastly, one of the things that Dr. Richardson and Dr. Kofer talked about was maintaining quality of the surgical skills out in the rural community. And I thought it was very impressive that the American College of Surgeons took this to heart, and they did a survey to rural surgeons. And then it was sponsored by the Nora Institute. And they said, what do y'all need? What do y'all need to learn? How can we keep you up to date? We know that you're so busy that it's hard to get away and come to different conferences. It's hard to get away even just for vacation sometimes. So, and it was simple things. Leadership and communication, how they can run their teams better at the hospital. Advanced endoscopy, they were already doing some, but maybe they want to start doing balloon dilatations. Maybe they want to put a colonic stent. Emergency gynecology, emergency urology, which emergency urology can be somebody who has urinary retention and have a difficult Foley placement. There's lots of skin lesions to excise out in the rural community. Things like breast ultrasound, using an ultrasound for central line placement. I mean, as I go forward, and Dr. Lehman, please cover your ears, but I may want to bring something special to Athens. Have you heard of robotic colonoscopy? Say, hello, roborectal, goodbye, alpha loops, as we crawl along. Really slowly. So I'm not here today to tell you that there's a golden band to lice to clear away the obstruction to access to surgical care. But there are governing bodies of surgery that are actively discussing and planning the future of general surgery training. And they're putting forth initiatives to solve this one aspect of the problem. And I'm very happy to know that we have such a man in our corner. This is a grassroots project about getting out the need for rural general surgeons.
Someone in Boston who trained in all the tertiary care centers, one minute is a chief fellow in the Leahy Clinic, and the next day he's in rural America. Basically, because I wanted to be busy and make a difference, and because my wife, who raised 27 miles from here.
You finish your training. It truly is just the beginning.
And so for about 20 years now, as part of that rural initiative that this institution started way before this rural surgery program came about, our residents have been going to Athens, and this is a great experience. When I was up there for 2 months, and we had our daughter, so I lost a little time on that, but still, 247 operations I was able to perform in that time. 135 for endoscopy, colonoscopy 86, upper endoscopy 49. I had 82 major cases and 30 specialty cases, which if you do the math, that 30 specialty cases, that's 12%. And it changed my plans. I was one of those ones that it switched. And we've got a great staff here, and they're here to help us and nurture us, and they want what's best for you. So I did the transition to practice fellowship. And in that 1 year, I got 556 operations, 90 in otolaryngology, 33 in thoracic, 52 in urology, 34 in rural surgery. I went back to Athens, hung out with Dr. Lehman, did more scopes, did some work with plastics. Got to hang out with Dr. Stanley and do a lot of complex laparoscopic cases. And then one of the niches I would like to help Dr. Lehman with, because it used to be a big part of his practice, is vascular access. So my assessment of the problem, it's workforce. There's a supply and demand issue. There's a new generation coming through, and we're going to have to be mentors to them, help with recruitment and training. And then the retention. And I'm happy to see that the United States government is stepping up, and they're going to start trying to actively recruit data to try to help out these rural communities and maybe provide some incentive. My plan? First, go to Skills Lab. Always my plan. Because perfect practice is what you need, right? Practice doesn't make perfect. Perfect practice makes perfect. So go there with a plan. Go there with an objective. Bring a friend. Help each other out. But on this topic, GME expansion. It's been, since 1997, the amount of graduates has been the same. That has to be expanded if we're to be able to keep up and adequately meet the demand that's of us. My plan would be to encourage all programs to foster diversity of training with the addition of rural rotations. It works. There's studies that show it, that it's a matter of us not being exposed to that kind of practice out there. We're just very fortunate here to have it. And we got to thank Dr. Lehman, Dr. Samita, and Dr. Brown. I mean, they put us up for free in a house, and they give their time to train us and show us their way of life. And then there's the transition to practice, or is now going to be called the mastery of general surgery. And this can be for those such as myself who maybe are going to an area, and I don't need orthopedics. There's orthopedics there. I didn't need too much OBGYN. They have those there. But there's four dialysis centers and no vascular surgeon. And there's quite a bit of frustration in that area because the patients don't know to go to Knoxville or come here and getting them put into clinics. Also ENT. There was an ENT surgeon who was there who grew up in Athens, and he's gone now. And they're actively trying to recruit an ENT surgeon, haven't been for the last 4 years. They have somebody from Knoxville coming down, but that's even been an issue. So me being able to provide a set of skill to help take care of those cases, that's what you want. You want to curtail your education, your skill set, and the Master of General Surgery can do that. And then outcomes and quality assessments. You want to continue for your rural surgeons to have good quality. And there are things such as the ACS NISQIP for small and rural. There's the Surgical Care Improvement Project, and there's even the Tennessee Surgical Quality Collaborative, and you can track your data. And this is good because, you know, it's like I said before, perfect practice makes perfect. It's not quantity of practice, because if you're doing the wrong thing a bunch, you're just going to continue doing the wrong thing. You're never going to get better. So to track your outcomes and look at the quality of the work that you're supplying, that's what's really important. And then I really look forward to see what they're able to accomplish with this Ensuring Access to General Surgery Act. To my fellow residents, don't give up. It's a long road, but it's a lot of fun. There is a light at the end of the tunnel. Sometimes you think it's a train. Most of the time it's an exit. And for my family, thank you.
Questions or comments for Nick? Yes, Dr. Barker.
Yeah, I had a question. I thought it was really great. I thought all the presentations today were really great. I had a question. Had you given any thought to a situation where a community physician could come into a hospital and do a rotation for maybe ENT when the ENT surgeon is not going to be there or he needs additional OB skills? As far as I know, that's really not something that's readily available. It's for a practicing rural physician to come into a teaching center and take a rotation and learn some skills and go back to the community. Do you think that, do you know of any place like that, or have you given that any thought if you're out there and you need additional skills?
So that's what the NORA Institute is trying to offer through the American College of Surgeons. There's actually a Rural Surgery Advisory Council that has been established. I believe it's 2013 they got established. The Rural Surgery Project, you saw Dr. Burns participating, it started up in 2015. And so that's what they're trying to bring. The biggest issues that they, when you survey the rural surgeons, is they to leave their community for a time, it's very hard for them to do that. Ask my future partner, it's very hard to walk away whenever you know you have clinic and you've got operations and patients are waiting for you, and to get away, and then you leave that. As you saw in Tennessee, there are some areas where there's only one general surgeon. So that one general surgeon leaves, now there's nobody on call. And some people, they don't want to go anywhere else, as the other data showed. So it becomes an issue, and that was one of the things that they talked about. There was one paper that talked about that tertiary care centers like Erlanger can help out their rural partners and maybe supply them with locum tenens so that those people can leave. I think it's really exciting that Erlanger is now supplying hospitalists, and there's going to be there's hospitalists in-house at all times, it sounds like, when I've talked to the staff.
Or maybe somebody from a tertiary care center could actually go to a rural hospital and provide education to those folks a certain amount of time.
That would be great. That part has not been – I didn't see that addressing. It was always the rural surgeon having to leave to go to –
The advisory council, that's one of the things we worked on, particularly the advisory council for rural surgery, and which I was privileged to be a part of, and those were two of the issues that were of greatest need that you've touched on, and as Nick said, the effort is to find as many of those things as you can and make it transportable to that local community. Now, you might have to, for example, transporting some of the things that he commented on there, the different categories, I can't remember, like ENT surgery or whatever, or evaluation of ENT patients, you might have to have two or three communities get together at the same time, people from Athens, Sweetwater, and Dayton or something, you know, as an example. But the college is making an effort to put that together. And has a few things already done. Amy Halverson, who did some of those surveys that you had, they had some data and they put together some, particularly about trauma and whatever. The second part of that, and we're still working on it, is to have the College of Surgeons set up a locum tenens business with an emphasis on providing the availability of verifiably good surgeons to come to your community and allow the surgeons that are there with confidence to feel they can take off time, because that's one of the biggest threats. And the biggest, if you survey rural surgeons, that's it. They wear out. Interestingly, their burnout rate is no higher, though, than the burnout rate in rural areas, so you get back to employment model and electronic medical record and all that. But we're working on, send Dr. Hoyt some letters. He's gotten them from me, and we talk about it a lot. And the locum tenens issue, which was initially thought not to be something that you could ever even think about doing, he just told me 2 weeks ago that the lawyers say we can do it. And so there's several things like that that the college should do, and that comes back to the admonition from our McCravey lecturer: get involved in the college and continue to push them, because if we don't do it as organized surgeons, it may not get done and probably won't. So I'm sorry to preach about that, but I hope we answered your question too. We're working on it. We're working on it at that level. Great job again. I want to remind everybody, 6 o'clock tonight, we're very proud that we have such a good crowd here today. This is fantastic. We're proud to have our new initiates, if you will, and look forward to you guys being there hopefully tonight and certainly through the next 6 years with you. And thank everybody for being here, and thank you for 5 great chief presidents and the great work they've done. Thanks very much.